ABC Sports presents the most prestigious auto racing event in America, the Indianapolis 500.
How fast is fast at Indianapolis? Well, in 1911, fast was 74 miles an hour, the average speed of Ray Haroon's winning car. But 74 years later, fast is 212 miles per hour, the four-lap average of Pancho Carter as he qualified. Pancho Carter, winner of the pole position at age 34, has finished in the top 10 here six times. His father finished fourth 33 years ago. Pancho won the pole with a Buick V6 engine, and a Buick won the second spot, too. 26-year-old Scott Brayton came here sponsored only by his family's finances, but picked up more sponsors when the speed of his car became apparent. With his talent and good looks, he has to be Coldwater, Michigan's most eligible bachelor. On the outside of the first row, you'll see this car driven by 32-year-old Bobby Rahal of Dublin, Ohio, just outside Columbus. Rahal finished seventh last year. He's an intelligent, articulate college graduate who looked as at home in his dinner clothes the night before last at a charity ball as he does in his flame-proof coveralls behind the wheel of his race car. That, then, is the first row. This is Mario Andretti with his baby son, Michael, not so many years ago. Today, father and son are competitors. Mario, the pre-race favorite, starting on the inside of row two at age 45. This is Mario's 20th start here. He won just once 16 years ago. Another father and son also face off as adversaries here. The Al Unsers, senior and junior of Albuquerque, New Mexico. Al Sr. is a three-time winner. His brother Bobby also won the great race three times. And now comes the next generation. The face behind that mask is still the face of a kid, although Al Jr. is a 23-year-old husband and father. There's a brother act in this year's race, Don and Bill Whittington of Fort Lauderdale, Florida. Don, the elder by 3 years, seems to have the better chance. He inherited the car of former winner Gordon Johncock when Johncock suddenly retired. Don Whittington will sit on the outside of row two. Rick Mears is the defending champion, but will have to move up from 10th starting position. At age 33, he has already won the 500 twice. Unlike most drivers, Rick found his road to the top in sprint buggies and off-road racing. It was a rugged introduction to the sport. Since then, he has found that there are good days and bad. Good days, like the celebration after last year's victory, but bad days too. Later last season, his feet were crushed in an accident. He spent painful months in the hospital, and today will limp to the car in his first race of 1985. Tom Sneva, too, knows about good days and bad. Three times he has sat on the pole. 2 years ago, he won the race. But in 1975, this was the end of his day. A wild, terrifying crash just under the luxury suites in turn two. A crash from which, miraculously, he emerged with minor injuries. Now at age 36, Tom Sneva tries again. He has traveled a long way from his original profession of school teacher, a long way from the halls of Ivy to the walls of Indy. Daniel John Sullivan III was born in Louisville 35 years ago, a talented driver, but is better known as the bon vivant of the circuit, more in the mold of the glamorous Grand Prix drivers of another time than the computer-driven technicians of today. And then there is A.J. A.J. Foyt, the epitome of everything that is Indy, the only four-time winner of the race competing for the 28th time at age 50. This was his wildest win, A.J. threading his way through wrecked cars and smoke on the final turn of the final lap, a breathtaking moment, but A.J. made it. Dwight Eisenhower was president when A.J. first came here. He endures, driver, chief mechanic, a jack of all racing trades in an era of specialization. A three-time winner just made it to the 10th row this year. Johnny Rutherford, Lone Star JR, had to bump the slowest car in the final hour of qualifying last Sunday to make the race. Old champs versus young, brother against brother, father against son in the world's most famous motor race. ABC Sports presents the Indianapolis 500. This is Jim McKay reporting live from the start-finish line at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. It's 8 o'clock in the evening here. The tumult and the shouting have long since died after today's running of the Indianapolis 500. The 400,000 or so people who are here have taken their memories home with them. All 270,000 permanent seats here are empty. There's nobody left, but we have ABC Sports and the people undertaking the thankless job of cleaning up. It's a very quiet place. Certainly not so shortly before 11 o'clock this morning. You know, the month of May is always special for me. It begins with the Kentucky Derby and ends with the Indianapolis 500. They're two of the world's greatest one-day sporting events. They take place within 100 miles of each other, and they're uniquely American. Midwest patriotic, heralding the coming of the good old summertime. And each begins with a song. Not a military march or a college fight song, but a song of longing for home. In Louisville, it's my old Kentucky home. And here in Indianapolis, back home again in Indiana.
Ladies and gentlemen, singing back home again in Indiana are the Voices of Liberty from Walt Disney World. And they are being conducted by none other than Mickey Mouse, the Grand Marshal of the 1985 Indianapolis 500 Festival Parade.
This is Tom Carnegie switching you.
The pageantry's been going on for almost 3 hours now. College bands and movie stars and Mickey Mouse and old race cars on parade. But all that is mere prelude to the race itself. 33 drivers soon will hear the command to start their engines, and the race will begin. One is named Danny Sullivan, and Sam Posey, my colleague in commentary here, is in communication with him as Danny sits in his car.
Danny, this is Sam Posey. How are you doing?
I'm doing great, Sam. Turn your volume down just a little bit, but everything's going great. This is an unbelievable spectacle.
In the warm-up laps before the start, in the next few minutes, what are the things you'll be looking for?
Looking for the wind, see how dirty the track is, just make sure everything's warming up okay, and just start my train of thought about what we're going to do at the start.
Thank you and good luck.
Americans are not given to brevity, but there are a few short sentences that we first hear as children and react to with excitement all our lives. The brief statements are, play ball, they're off, and gentlemen, start your engines. The command about to be given by Mrs. Mary Hullman, the widow of the man who made the Speedway what it is today.
Gentlemen, start your engines.
Now the first thing we wonder is, did they all get started? We can't really be sure until they begin to move out. But this is the moment when there's no turning back. Now the commitment is made to parade your car before 400,000 spectators on the scene, then to accelerate on the pace lap, watch for the green flag from the starter, and then to race for riches and glory. There's Dwayne Pancho Carter, the pole sitter, trying to do what his father could not do before him to win an Indy. Next to him, young Scott Brayton, another race driver's son. They say they're old drivers and bold drivers, but no old bile drivers. Well, Scott Brayton is young, 26. Bobby Rahal rounding out the first row, a thinking man's driver, not the instinctive natural athlete. None of these three, remember, has ever started on the front row before. There's Mario Andretti, the favorite at age 45, 16 years after his only victory in the 500. He's right behind Carter, the pole sitter. Will he go for the lead in turn one? Defending champion Rick Mears has to wonder if his battered feet crushed in that accident last year will sustain the test of 500 miles. And someday there will be an Indy without A.J. Foyt, but not this year. At age 50, the only four-time winner tries again, refusing to hear the voices that say it may be time to retire. Johnny Rutherford. Johnny Rutherford, too, represents the generation that's beginning to give way. At age 47, he starts way back in row 10. Tom Sneva, he won this race. He sat on the pole a couple of times. He had a terrible crash here in another year. He has seen it all at Indy. In row two, it looks like Emerson Fittipaldi may have a problem there getting the car started, one of the Pat Patrick cars, and perhaps the other Patrick car driven by Don Whittington. Number 40 there is Fittipaldi. Now, I think maybe they got him, or are they gonna have to push him? Fittipaldi still sitting there. Now they're all the engines are running, and now they're moving out. I think everybody is okay. Wait a minute. Rick Mears, the defending champion, has not started the first major story of this year's 500-mile race in the most meticulously prepared team, that of Roger Penske. One car has not started, and now he's got it. And the first great cheer of the day goes up. They're all underway at Indy. I can't remember a more beautiful day for the running of the Indianapolis 500. The temperature is about 80 degrees. There is a breeze about 8 miles per hour right now. It could become significant later on, but right now it's just pleasant. Working with us will be in the pit area, first of all, Jim Lampley and Jack Arute. Back in the garage area, Bill Fleming, and with me in the commentary booth, the well-known American race driver and our resident expert on the sport, Sam Posey. Sam, we've been talking about the changing of the guard for a few years here, but it hasn't really happened yet. And yet this time we find ourselves with three men on the front row, none of whom have ever been on the front row before. Is it that significant, or does it just sort of happen that way?
No, I think it is starting to be significant. We've got Bobby Rahal, Danny Sullivan, Al Unser Jr., all in this race with a better chance to win than A.J. Foyt or Johnny Rutherford. So there is a change, but it's evolutionary, not revolutionary. And you're going to recognize many of the big names as favorites. Mario Andretti, Al Unser Sr. These are men that have very, very good shots at the race, and they're familiar names. To me, the big question is the Buicks in the front row. And here's the real change. Two stock block engines that have been the fastest qualifiers for this race in the hands of Pancho Carter and Scott Brayton. What's going to happen? It's an imponderable at this point. They may not last the race. Nobody really knows. The issue may be a fuel consumption issue. Everybody gets the same amount of fuel. Can they run as fast relative to the rest of the cars as they were able to run in qualifying with this fuel restriction? It's going to be very interesting.
What about the heat? It's a hot day.
Heat affects everything. The hotter it is, the less reliable the engines are, the more likely any mechanical part is to fail, and the more likely the possibility of human error. We were just talking to Roger Penske moments ago, and he said, you know, the more chances for mistakes are, the better shot the experienced men have, and it is a hot day.
All right, Sam, now let's set the field. In row one, Pancho Carter, the fastest qualifier at more than 212 miles per hour. His car powered by a Buick V6. Can the Buicks last the race? Many are asking that question. Scott Brayton also is Buick powered, sitting right beside Pancho. Bobby Rahal on the outside has a Cosworth specially built racing engine like most of the field. Row two features two Formula One former world champions, Mario Andretti and Emerson Fittipaldi of Brazil. Don Whittington knows he's in exalted company on the outside. This is the best ride of his career. Row three, Al Unser Sr., after his fourth Indy triumph as he nears his 46th birthday. Danny Sullivan thinks it's time for glory at age 35. And Jeff Brabham would like to honor the family name. His father, Jack, was a multiple world champion. Row four features the defending champion, Rick Mears, going okay right now. In fact, they tell us it wasn't the starting problem at all. They were just getting his belts adjusted. Al Unser Jr. there and Bill Whittington, the brother of Don. And there are stories all through the other rows. Former champion Tom Sneva and Mario Andretti's son Michael. The South Americans, Guerrero and Garza and Bozell. Leyendijk, the Dutchman, and A.J. Foyt. Parsons and Bettenhausen, sons of champions. The Irishman Daly, the Scotsman Crawford, and Rich Bogler rounding out the field. It's really something.
It is, Jim. You know, despite the sound of your engine and despite having your helmet on, you hear that crowd. You hear them cheering for you. And, you know, there's Brayton's dad, Lee Brayton, who started him in this whole business. And, you know, you that's Debbie Ray Hall. They are probably sharing some of this sense of euphoria. Carla Carter there, Pancho Carter's wife. A sense of euphoria can overcome you, actually, as you hear the crowd. You see them there waving and cheering for you. And, Jim, of course, you've got to keep iron control of yourself. You can't give in to that. It's supposed to go green now very soon.
You remember it well from driving the race yourself. Jim Garner, the actor and sometime race driver, is driving the pace car this year, which is really a very real responsibility.
I think we're going to see a very fast start, paced by Pancho Carter, who's a former sprint car man. I think he'll bring him down very fast. I look for a safe start.
Watching for the green flag from starter Dwayne Sweeney, the crowd cheering, urging them on. This could be the time. It should be. There's Sweeney with the flag in his hand. Here come the cars, and they're racing at Indianapolis. There goes Pancho Carter on the radio screen, headed for turn one. Brayton and Ray Hall, and Ray Hall going low, getting the lead. Bobby Ray Hall takes the lead. Brayton is second. Carter is third. Mario Andretti moving on the outside.
Ray Hall, unexpectedly, we didn't think he'd have the power in that Cosworth engine to take the lead from the Buicks. But Ray Hall making an outside move, took a clean lead. He's probably going, he's midway down the backstretch, probably going about 216, 220, right here, Jim.
And the sound that you heard was not an explosion from any car. That's the traditional fireworks that go off, signaling the start of the race.
Mario Andretti there in second place, Jim. Mario told me shortly before the start, he said, Sam, I think I have the best chance I have ever had to win this race.
Well, we conjectured before the race, would he go for the lead in turn one? He did. Bobby Ray Hall got there first. Scott Brayton is third right now. Carter is fourth.
First lap run at 189 miles an hour, and change, Jim. It was a little slower start than I anticipated, and it is a hot day, which may keep the speeds down slightly.
When they're on the straightaways, remember, they're going the distance of a full football field, including the end zone, every second.
I missed a guess. I figured that the Buick engine guys, Brayton and Carter, would turn the boost up and try to lead at least a little bit. Both of them right now are well positioned and driving cautious races.
So it's still Bobby Ray Hall of Columbus, Ohio, in the lead. Mario Andretti, born in Italy, from Nazareth, PA, in second place. And in third place, the young Turk, 26-year-old Scott Brayton.
At this stage, Jim, let's see, second lap, 201 miles an hour, so they're already over 200 in their lap speed. They are coping for the first time in this season with these new cars, and there's a possibility of a change in third. There is Brayton running third, Scott Brayton.
And in fourth place now, we have Emerson Fittipaldi of Brazil, the former World Grand Prix Formula One champion. Driving. Who has really taken to the American scene.
Oh, he really has. Driving for the Pat Patrick team. There's Fittipaldi right there doing, I think, a beautiful job considering his lack of experience in the oval kind of racing. But Jim, they are experiencing here for the first time today the turbulence that's felt as these ground effect cars cut the wind and the cars behind them run into turbulent air. In fact, that may be why they're spaced out the way they are. They're trying to feel what that turbulence is like, how it affects their car before making any moves. I think we're seeing a cautious race by the leaders.
Sam, with 500 miles ahead of you, what is the particular advantage, really, of getting the lead? There are going to be multiple pit stops. All sorts of things are going to happen.
Well, yeah, exactly. And I think that, you know, as Chuck Yeager, the great flyer, said, you know, flying in combat, you really don't give a lot of thought to the outcome. If you do, you worry yourself to death. And I don't think these men are thinking ahead to the end of the race now. They're feeling their car, feeling the situation, like the turbulence, like the extra heat that's in the track. How are their cars handling? Are their radios working? That's what you're seeing going on right now.
There is Dwayne Pancho Carter, who sat on the pole in this race, coming into the pits for a very unscheduled pit stop. People had wondered if the Buicks could last the race, but my goodness, it's only a few laps, and there he is.
This is much earlier. I'm obviously, it indicates trouble. The smoke is coming from the area of the either the transmission or the turbocharger. It may not be the engine that has failed here, but rather it could be the transmission, which takes that extra power of the Buick and may have weakened under the strain. A lot of smoke, though. An oil leak is the most likely thing here. What a crushing disappointment, Jim.
It certainly is. Well into his 30s, Pancho Carter has finished in the top 10 six times in Indianapolis. He's no young Turk on this tour. This would have been the time for him to win. But the race goes on, and it is still Bobby Rahal in car number 10 leading them all. Rahal started in sports cars, as you did, Sam, made his way slowly to Indianapolis, but made his mark quickly once he got here.
Rahal goes by with Andretti and Brayton right behind him, and there is Emerson Fittipaldi. They are the top four, running very clearly with an equal gap between each of them. There is Emerson Fittipaldi making turn one at Indianapolis in front of the biggest crowd he has ever raced in front of.
And behind him in fifth place now, we have a man who could certainly become a factor, Al Unser Sr. in one of the Penske-prepared cars, and then Danny Sullivan in another Penske. And so they're all off to a safe start, and Rahal is first of all at Indianapolis.
ABC Sports exclusive coverage of the 69th Indianapolis 500 is brought to you by Goodyear, makers of the Eagle, the high-performance radial engineered for cars with the proper qualifications. By Light Beer from Miller, everything you've always wanted in a beer and less. By Team Xerox, the right products and right people all working together. And by Chevrolet, who invite you to see today's Chevy, drive today's Chevy, live today's Chevy.
Well, there's a lot of pride in Columbus, Ohio right now because the man leading the Indianapolis 500 is Bobby Rahal, who lives just outside that city in Dublin. Bobby Rahal, at age 32, in first place at Indy.
He once said,
There we have Pancho Carter still in the pits.
No progress there at all.
No, they're not making any headway. For a moment, it looked like something might be happening.
Well, Jim, Pancho Carter brought his car in under power, but then when he brought the car up on the jacks, the motor failed. They pulled the bonnet off the back. They're looking very seriously over the engine, and it could be what everybody thought would happen to the Buicks. It could be an early expiration for this stock block machine.
That was Jack Arut reporting from the pits, and here is Josela Garza, the young man who made a splash here as a rookie from Mexico a few years ago.
He's in his fifth race here, Jim. He has yet to really score a success. Of course, there's the yellow being waved. There's Bobby Rahal really easing
now
into the pits.
A yellow flag out because of the lone engine of Josela Garza in car number 55. The leaders begin to make sort of bonus pit stops. These don't hurt you like the ones under the green. That's Rahal, the leader. And there, Andretti already out.
Oh, look at Andretti spinning his wheels on the way back. By contrast, Rahal is losing a lot of time. You see him on the right of the screen in this stop. Andretti, there goes Rahal out of the pits, but he was slow in, and he spent quite a lot of time there. The fact that it's yellow means it probably won't have cost him much more than a position. We can expect this to shake back out probably with Andretti in the lead.
Remember now, unlike the way it was here in years gone by, you may close up under the yellow flag. You didn't used to be able to do that here.
Yes, there goes Rahal.
There is Rahal. It is really difficult for you to understand how fast and how good the pit crews are at Indianapolis. Each year we tried to show it to you and compare it to something else in some way to communicate it. This time, Jack Arut had a good idea. Here's what he came up with.
How you doing today, Mr. Arut?
How can I help you?
Willie, just fill it up and check the oil.
Okay.
You know, Willie takes good care of my car, but boy, I wonder what it'd be like to get service from a top-notch Indy crew. Just think, the Patrick Racing Team working on my car. Yeah, it'd take a while, though, for them to get the darn car up off the ground with one of those old jacks you find around the gas station. Those Indy cars, though, boy, they've got that pneumatic jack system. You just snap the air hose onto the car's coupler and whammo, it's up in a couple of seconds. And changing tires? Well, they've got one lug nut and they spin it off and make the change in about 6 seconds. 6 seconds. Heck, it'd have taken that long to get the hubcap off of my car. And then they've got those five lug nuts that they got to take off the wheel. I just don't know. They can take a lot of fuel on quicker, too. 40 gallons of methanol in 14 seconds. Yeah, they've got that aircraft-type quick connect system, and that really lets the fuel flow. But even with them, they'd have to take off the darn gas cap and wait and wait and wait for the pumps to work. You know, it's a good thing I don't need 40 gallons, though. I'd probably be here all day and owe them a fortune. Some life those drivers have got. Boy, just think, they get a drink and don't even have to leave the car. Sure, it's only water. I don't know. I think I'd still rather get out and get a nice cold soda pop. Yeah, but an IndyCar crew now, they'd come in handy. They could trim the aerodynamics on this old heap. I don't know. What, am I crazy? I mean, I've got to be out of my mind. Willie's fine for my car. But you know, I wonder how old Willie'd do with an Indy car.
See you later, Mr. Root.
Okay, our thanks to the Pat Patrick crew for cooperating with us on our little flight of fancy. Here comes the green flag. Racing again at Indianapolis. Bobby Rahal still leading, being pursued by Mario Andretti. Two red cars, and there, smoke coming from the car of Scott Brayton, who has been running in third place in the race. That's the second Buick to go.
Yep, both Buicks suddenly stricken with at least very serious problems, whether they're engine related or not. But you know, Jim, I still admire the teams for having tried this. The Gallus team there with Pancho Carter driving Scott Brayton's own team. They tried something American, they tried something different. For Buick, they're not really in the racing business. It's just a way of kind of tapping the American public on the shoulder and saying, hey, look, we're interested, we're doing something.
And they did, after all, win the pole position and the one next to it for Indianapolis. Back again at Indianapolis. There are the standings now. Mario Andretti in the lead. Bobby Rahal now second. And Al Unser Sr. is in third position. Mario Andretti trying to...
Jim, there's some debris, a bag, some kind of plastic junk that's come and lodged on the nose of Andretti's car.
Now, yeah.
I don't know if that would be serious. There's a close-up of it. If it went back into the duct, if it flew off the nose and went back into the duct, there's a radiator back in there, then it could block partially, at least, the airflow over the radiator. That would be typical Andretti racing luck at Indianapolis.
Well, you can look at his record since he won the race in 1969, and you see accident, out of fuel, burned piston, valve, accident, broken header, engine, accident, accident.
A kind of litany of fiasco and the things that can go wrong.
Now, Al Unser running very well here in third place, but we've gotten an unconfirmed report on one of the radios that he may be penalized, possibly penalized one lap or some other penalty for running over his own air hose in the pits, which is strictly prohibited. That's unconfirmed right now. Al Unser in car number 11. Well, here he is. There's Rick Mears coming into the pits now. Let's go down and get a report from Jackaroo.
Rick Mears has come in, and it's a break for them under the yellow to take on fuel. They check the tires, but the one major repair that's going on, Jim, is in the helmet area. The screw on the outside of his visor that keeps the visor in the locked position has come unhinged, and they're going to have to replace it. They sent one of the team members all the way back to the garage area to get a new helmet, remove the pin, and now they're accomplishing the task, and he's away.
Well, you remember the old fairy tale, for one of a nail, a shoe was lost, for one of a shoe, the horse was lost, and there it is, one little tiny screw. I understand you all have an update on Pancho, Jack.
For Pancho Carter, the problems continue. He's not been back out on the racetrack since he had the problem. They've removed the oil cooler. They've checked that. They put it back on because that's okay. They looked at the valve train, and they think that that might be where the problem is.
Sam Posey, Sam, you have the radio in your hand. Why don't we see if we can talk to Bobby Rahal in that car number 10?
Bobby, this is Sam Posey. Can you hear me?
Yeah, Samuel.
Are things going as well for you as they appear to be? Is everything running well?
Well, everything's running real good right now. It's got a little bit of a push, but nothing horrible. I'm just trying to not lean on the tires very much and drive as smooth as I can, but no, everything feels good right now.
Did you have any idea that you would be able to keep the Buicks behind you in the early going that easily?
Well, I don't know. I think I got the jump on brakes a little bit. I don't know what happened to Carter. But, yeah, you know, I figured we were ahead. I might as well take the corner and go for it.
Carter had valve train troubles. What is the heat doing to you? Anything?
I'm sorry, you broke up a bit.
How about the heat? Is it bothering you? It's hot there.
Really, it's not too bad. And the wind's a little bothersome, but the heat so far isn't very bad at all. We've got a good air conditioner in this car.
Thank you very much. Continued good luck to you.
Okay, Bobby Rahal in the car. Still under the yellow, of course. And there is flagman Duane Sweeney. Jack Arud has been checking up on the Al Unser story. There is Al in that car number 11. Will he or will he not be penalized a lap? What's the story, Jack?
Well, Jim, this is a game of inches, and he ran over this hose by about 2 inches during his last pit stop. The USAC officials have notified the team that they have caught the infraction, and they're waiting to determine what the penalty will be.
Well, now, actually, Jack, we get the official word from another source that they will, in fact, be penalized one lap. So Al Unser has one full lap to make up if he's going to get back among the leaders. A tough break. The yellow that came out because of Scott Brayton took three laps after his engine blew before they put it out.
ABC Sports exclusive coverage of the Indianapolis 500 continues.
We're on lap 32 of a scheduled 200 in the Indianapolis 500, and Mario Andretti leads the race 16 years after he won it once. In second place, Bobby Rahal. Third place, Emerson Fittipaldi. Fourth place, Al Unser Jr., who has moved up from 11th place on the starting grid to fourth in the standings. Bill Fleming is down with Pancho Garter in the garage area.
Pole sitter and the first man out of the race. Pancho, what happened?
Well, we're not sure exactly what it was, but we've experienced an oil problem. We believe that the oil pump, scavenge pump, has quit functioning and is no longer pulling oil out of the engine and back into the oil tank. And
did you get some high temps real early, because you didn't really have anything at the start?
No, we had the engine was down on horsepower, and I believe that was due to the fact that it was more or less running in its own oil. Usually you sump most of the oil out of the engine, it just runs on the pressurized oil coming into the engine. And it was down on horsepower, and we started experiencing some high oil temperatures, and then it started bailing oil out of it and smoking, and it was obvious I was gonna have to bring it in to see if they could fix it.
Well, Mario Andretti was the pre-race favorite here, and in the early going he's certainly living up to that. He has a 5-second lead on the rest of the field now.
Interestingly, Jim, Mario is driving a Lola. Almost all the other cars in the race, 25 of them to be exact, are March cars. All these cars are built in England. There's 6 Lolas in the race, 25 Marches, 2 Eagles. But Mario has taken a different kind of approach, a car that's different from most of the others. And it'll be interesting to see during the day how it stacks up against these much more numerous Marches. I still don't like that. Whatever that paper is on the nose of his car, that poses a threat, no question about it.
Mario Andretti, one of the most remarkable figures in the sport of motor racing. Let's meet him.
The date is 1941. The place, Trieste, Italy. The pig's name is not known, but the little boy's is, Mario Andretti. Today, Mario is 45. His is the story of a voyager, first from Italy to America, from the old world to the new. Then, the longer, stranger voyage in his years behind the wheel, as he has pursued an understanding of speed and its mysteries that today makes him unique in this sport.
You would think in his 40s that he would leave a little cushion for himself, that he wouldn't run up against the wall when he comes out of turn 4. And that he would give himself a little extra something to cushion himself. And he doesn't. He simply takes it right to the edge every time he goes out. to qualify, and is apparent when he comes into the pits. I mean, everything is going. The adrenaline is pumping. You can see his pulse is up to about 163. And he's just as fierce now as he was when I first met him.
The fierceness was there from the beginning. Mario always seemed to have something in his sights that was bigger than a specific race or championship. He raced everything he could get his hands on. Indy cars, stock cars, sports cars. He was an elemental force, not as interested in calculating the odds and winning by small margins as he was in a sort of lordship over the nature of speed. It was a trail of broken cars, mostly not his fault, but either way, there were never any apologies given or necessary.
I don't think I had as complete an idea as to exactly where I was going as I do today, perhaps. At the early stage of a career, you're searching, you're still searching where you want to be, what the potentials are. Sure, you have high goals, very ambitious goals, but practically, you just really don't know whether you can achieve that. So, you're just really searching.
What he sought, and it had been a dream from childhood, was the crown of European Grand Prix racing, the World Championship. It took time and several different teams until he had what he wanted, a swift black Lotus no one could catch. Monza, Italy, September 78. He would clinch the title in the country in which he was born on a day of tragedy. His teammate Ronnie Peterson would be killed in this accident just after the start. Mario had seen other friends die too, but somehow he was never deflected from his original sense of purpose. The World Championship was destiny fulfilled. Andretti was 38, a millionaire, a legend, a man with talented sons following in his footsteps. It wasn't enough. With Paul Newman and Carl Haas, he formed a team that would attack Indy in the national championship. A major goal was a second Indy win. Crashes here in the last 3 years, not of his making. This one when he was driving for Pat Patrick have only deepened his resolve. His team has won nearly everything else, including the national championship and the first race of this year.
When I'm out there after something, I really want it badly. I'm not just out there just for fun and games. And I go after it with all my might. I'm not always armed the way I want it to be. Sometimes the bullet's just a little bit too small, but I go after it.
Go after it he has. The little boy who so long ago had the pig by the tail is now a man with the world in the palm of his hand.
So it would seem at this moment, Mario Andretti leading still at Indianapolis. Emerson Fittipaldi of Brazil has now moved ahead of Bobby Rahal into second place in the race. Two former World Grand Prix Formula One driving champions now running 1-2. And now here into the pits comes the leader in the race. Jim Lampley is standing by in his pit area.
Pit for a routine stop, his second pit stop of the race so far. The right side rubber being changed, refueling taking place. There is an air of continued tension in this pit, somewhat different from that of Rahal just a few pits away, where it is somewhat more relaxed. Perhaps that has to do, of course, with the history of misfortune that Mario has suffered in his 19 tries in Indianapolis. In and out in just about 20 seconds, an excellent pit stop for Andretti.
A very good pit stop for Mario Andretti, but that pit stop, at least for the moment, gives the lead to Emerson Fittipaldi of Brazil, who a good many years ago was the youngest man ever to win the World Grand Prix Championship. Now at the age of 38, has come to America and absolutely loves it over here, doesn't he?
Well, he does. Jim, Emerson told us that Indy's, the crowd, the size of it, the enthusiasm reminds him of the Brazilian soccer crowds back in Rio when he was a kid. He loves it here.
Indy is certainly very much like a Brazilian soccer crowd, only there are 400,000 here. Well, they do have a soccer stadium in Rio that'll hold 200,000,
wow.
The biggest in the world. They're the standing. Fittipaldi, Rahal, Unser Jr., Whittington, Guerrero.
Built in 1909, the Indianapolis Motor Speedway is the oldest track in the world.
Fittipaldi, the Brazilian, leading the Indianapolis 500 now with Bobby Rahal second, Al Unser Jr. third. Then you go to Don Whittington and Roberto Guerrero. Mario Andretti, who had met, has dropped down to sixth place, but that's because he's made a pit stop and the others have not. And now here into the pits comes Fittipaldi.
down that rough pit lane, which they don't repave, I think, to keep it a little bit slow, Jim. It's rough like that.
Like bumps on your neighborhood street that they put
speed
in for
bumps.
Children, yeah.
Exactly. All right, here's the Pat Patrick team, which we saw earlier in our pit stop demonstration, doing it for real. Former world champion Emerson Fittipaldi's car. At this stage in the race, the fuel, 40 gallons of it, flows in very fast because there's still plenty of fuel left in the tank to push down, give it some pressure. Later in the race, we may see slower pit stops there. Interesting how many foreigners are in this race, Jim, this year. Eight of them.
More than ever before,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, six last year, five back in 1960. Way back in 1967, so suddenly there's a whole influx of Europeans, largely because of their road racing skills, I think.
Well, that pit stop by Fittipaldi gives the lead back again to Bobby Rahal, but here he comes into the pits to make his pit stop.
Yep, comes in very slowly, and you know...
Oh, they're opening up something.
Yep, they're starting to take the back off the car. That is, of course, a bad sign. Something's wrong here. I have no idea. There's no smoke or anything. They've taken off, they took that hatch off where the turbo charger is. Sometimes the wastegates fail on turbos. They are looking at the turbo, Jim.
Yep. Seconds clicking away. And with it, the lead and many, many places in the Indianapolis 500. A look from the other side. They are working on the turbo. Jack Arruda is with Scott Brayton.
For Scott Brayton, it's an early departure after a wonderful month of May that put him on the front row. Scott, what put you out of this race?
Well, I really couldn't tell you, Jack. The mechanics are going to have to get back there and look at it. Coming down the front straightaway, I felt a little vibration in the back, and I lost some boost pressure on my gauge, and so I had to shut the V6 off. But up to that point, we were performing well. I was just, you know, the car was handling. I didn't quite have what I needed to get around the Cosworth at the end of the shoot, but I'm happy, and I'm very happy to have the one-lap record, and I'm just looking forward to coming back.
Okay, Scott Brayton out of it, but out of it very gracefully. And now the lead has gone over to Danny Sullivan in car number five. He had been running seventh, but again, because of these pit stops and the fact that he has not yet made his pit stop, he is the leader, but he's going to have to come in pretty soon.
Correct. This is a temporary situation here on the track. The pit stops, of course,
there he is.
You see him ducking in. Do reshuffle things enormously here at Indy.
Danny Sullivan of the Roger Penske team. They have three cars in here, remember. Rick Mears, the defending champion, Al Unser Sr., and Danny Sullivan.
They had a pit stop contest here at Indy the other day, Jim. Danny Sullivan won that. We'll see that pit stop winning crew in action. Penske's men,
they
so rarely
smooth.
Make a mistake. However, that Al Unser problem when they ran over the air hose was uncharacteristic. That may be very costly.
And now it appears that all of the leaders have made their pit stops, as a result of which Mario Andretti is back in the lead.
Here he is. Mario Andretti. Now, of course, with the whatever it was, that plastic, that lodged on the nose, has been removed.
Okay, yeah, they have removed that. In fact, Jim Lampley is down in the pits. I think he has the villain with him.
I'm holding in my hand the polyurethane bag which rode with Mario Andretti in car number three for all those miles. Nothing more nor less than a piece of garbage from the track. A great way to shop, a great way to save, it says. Mario Andretti may have saved himself a lot of time and trouble by letting it ride instead of stopping to get it off.
Okay, thank you, Jim. It's still Mario Andretti leading the race. Tom Sneave is now second, but once again, he's about the last one that has not made pit stop. In third place, Fittipaldi, then Al Unser Jr., then Don Whittington, and then Rick Mears, the defending champion. Sam, we're a little more than a quarter of the way through the race. It seems to me that the two biggest stories so far were both predicted by many people: the failure of the Buicks of Pancho Carter and Scott Brayton, and the success of Mario Andretti, the favorite in the race.
Yes, but I think the way success is coming to Mario is the way it has not come to him in the last few years, which is a
little bit through luck. He had that bag on the nose of his car. It did not, this time, screw up his radiator. He's had failures by some of his toughest competition. Al Unser running over his own air hose. Rick Mears having trouble with his visor. Bobby Rahal having trouble. Suddenly, the race is coming to Mario very early in the going. Unusual.
How about two people moving up through the pack, though? Al Unser Jr. and Rick Mears.
Well, very, very tough. Mears, of course, had the problem at the start. He was late getting into his car. They had trouble getting the belt. He was kind of discombobulated, oddly enough, in the early stages. But he's now back on course. He's starting to lap over 202 miles an hour. Rick Mears is becoming a force again, provided, of course, the injuries to his feet did not prove to be critical later in the game.
And so, after 65 of a scheduled 200 laps, Andretti the leader, then Emerson Fittipaldi, Al Unser Jr., Don Whittington, and Rick Mears, the defending champion. Then Danny Sullivan in there, Roberto Guerrero of Colombia, Tom Sneva, who has won this race, remember, Jeff Brabham of Australia, and Johnny Rutherford, a three-time winner of the race. So that is the way they stand as the race goes on. Clear skies, a beautiful day, the temperature about 82. Into the pits comes the remarkable A.J. Foyt at the age of 50, still carrying on in Indianapolis, the only four-time winner of the race. And the interesting thing here, although he's running way back in 20th place at the moment, is that the next time, look at that, is that typical A.J. Foyt gesturing, telling the crew what to do, but using up time right now. But the next time he crosses that start-finish line, he will have gone 10,000 miles on this racetrack. Nobody else ever even close to that. Will he make that one more lap?
Well,
there's a problem.
Jim, of course, this is the kind of discussion that you're supposed to have by radio with your crew. Now, why AJ did not have that discussion by radio beats me. Is the radio not working? Does he just choose not to use it? Or was there some development as he was coming into the pit?
But this is vintage AJ Foyt, as we said, 50 years old, 20th place, and he is just as angry as he would be if he just lost the lead.
Yeah, but darn it, Jim, what isn't vintage A.J. Foyt is that he should be up front in this race, not back in 20th. He was 20th when he came in. As you said, there seems to be a problem there with the right rear. That man is working on it. And now, of course, he's going to be way further back.
A.J. Foyt, of course, nowadays has many other interests, principally his large stable of thoroughbred racehorses. His son, A.J. Foyt, third, training now, and training for the great Calumet Farm, by the way. Moving up in his profession. Oh, this is a long one. A long pit stop. Wait a minute, looks like is he getting out? Looks like he was going to the belts.
It would be incredible if he got out one lap short of the 10,000 mile mark, and I think that's exactly what he's doing. And you know, I think he's just plain mad at his crew. I mean, I'm not sure that car is out of action, that it can't be put right. I mean, I'm not saying.
But it looks, as of this moment, like he may have stopped in this race at 9,997 and a half miles.
And he is going to work on the car himself. Jim, you said it yourself, vintage A.J. Foyt.
What you're looking at right here is an anachronism, really.
Look at that. You see this what's wrong. Yeah, the wing, which he was trying to describe, is loose. And that is a legitimate major problem if you're trying to run over 200 miles an hour. If that wing, that front dive fin, was flapping back and forth, that could have been trouble.
But that's what it looked like 50, 60 years ago, when the drivers would help the mechanics work on the car. He's still his own chief mechanic. And now out on the race course, number 29, that's Derek Daly of Ireland. He's stopped, and the yellow comes out. So, well, look at this here. They had a fire back in AJ's car. Seemed to have it under control. You can't see alcohol fires, you know. Water and fire extinguishers. Oh, it's okay. There is number 5, Danny Sullivan, at the moment running in 7th place in the race. Let's see if we can talk to him, Sam.
Danny, it's Sam Posey. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I read you loud and clear, Sam.
Danny, there was so much talk before the race about the turbulence. You've been running in heavy traffic. Has turbulence been a problem for you?
Yeah, Sam, it has. There's quite a bit of turbulence around the head, so you get a lot of buffeting, but also it affects the handling of the car. but we're just making little adjustments to adapt for it.
How would you assess your race so far?
Well, it's going pretty good. I guess we led there for a while. I'd like to be a little bit more at the front, but we're right on schedule at the moment.
And the handling of your car, how's it going?
Oh, pretty good. We got a little bit of push that last time. We lost a little ground. We hope we fixed it on this pit stop and this set of tires.
Thanks very much. Continued good luck to you.
Thank you.
And there is his crew chief, Roger Penske. Now, right now, Jack Arruda is with A.J. Foyt.
A.J., what happened?
Well, the right front wing broke early in the race, the adjustment, and I couldn't have no right front wing, and all I could do was push, push, push.
And then the fire in the pits, how did that happen?
Well, it was pressurized, and we released some pressure, and I spilled some fuel there, and then it ignited.
1 mile short of 10,000 miles, 1 mile short. You got to wait till next year.
I'm not going to worry about it.
Not going to worry about it. One lap, of course, short of the 10,000 miles, what Jack meant there. A.J. Foyt walking at home at Indy. Good-looking shot, a moving shot from the sky cam of this crowd as you look at the standings after 67 laps at Indy.
From the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, the Indianapolis 500 continues.
While we're under the yellow, I'd like to take a minute to talk about next Saturday's ABC's Wide World of Sports, because it's a little different. Through the years of the past 24 years that we've been on the air, we've shown you many things that had to do with mountaineering, most of them spectacular. I remember particularly a British team scaling something called the Old Man of Hoy, an austere rock off Scotland. And then there was a team of mountaineers on another occasion scaling the Eiffel Tower using only the rivet heads for footholds. It's going to be something like that from Yosemite National Park next Saturday. Let's learn about it.
No million-dollar contract, no stadium full of fans. The story is simple, man versus rock. Lost Arrow Spire lies 3,000 feet above the floor of majestic Yosemite National Park. Following a spectacular and treacherous route, two of the world's premier climbers will attempt to reach the summit using only their hands and feet. This daring attempt will be captured live, plus a Joan Benoit and Greta Weitz showdown in the New York City Mini Marathon on ABC's Wide World of Sports Saturday.
Reminds me of the Wide World we were doing years ago. It all began. There are the standings at Indianapolis: Andretti, Fittipaldi, Sneva, Al Unser Jr., and Don Whittington. A great duel for third, though, between Al Unser Jr. and Tom Sneva.
Right. See Mario there.
Yep.
Running quite low on the track, incidentally.
Green flag, obviously, just came out. See if we can get a look at this battle for third and fourth. Here they are, right here. Yeah. Okay. Al Unser Jr. Car number 30. I am just nipped by Tom Sneva.
Sneva and Al Unser Jr. racing at very close quarters. There's Sneva running down almost onto the grass as Al Unser Jr., who's car is red at the front and blue at the back. It's the Doug Shearson car, number 30. You see it right there leading that clump with Sneva right behind him now. Sneva in the Eagle, the Dan Gurney Eagle, Doug Shearson car, and the Eagle running together. That car that Al Unser Jr. is driving now is the car that Danny Sullivan drove last year. He switched teams to join Roger Penske. Good battle, and in heavy traffic, too. Jim, two drivers. It's funny, Sneva has so much more experience here than Little Al, and yet they both drive like such veterans because Little Al is so good.
Unser, as we said, just 23 years old. Quite a story are the Unsers of Albuquerque, New Mexico. Head down the street in Albuquerque, New Mexico, past the Far West nightclub, and you're on the right road to Al Unser's place. We found the three-time Indianapolis champion at home with his son, Al Jr. Al Sr. is just 3 days from his 46th birthday. His son is 23, but on the race course, they're equals, and they're not unaware of who is driving that other car. 1983 was a classic example of that. Al Jr., late in the race, found himself sandwiched between his father, who was leading, and Tom Sneva, who was in second place. It appeared that the son was running interference for his dad, ignoring the move-over flag, keeping Sneva at bay for many laps. He didn't deny it after the race.
There was a time when the flagman was trying to wave you over to let Sneva by. Did you ever see the flagman doing that?
Nope. Sure, I saw him, but I wasn't going to, you know. There was, I was holding my ground, and I wasn't blocking Sneva, but, you know, I was holding my own ground, and if I could help Dad win the race, I was going to.
That's racing, right?
That's racing, yep.
Well, that was young Al in the immediacy of a racetrack interview. After a year's reflection and far from the sound of engines, the story was slightly different.
For my father, I wouldn't block, you know. I had the opportunity to, you know, I could have crashed both me and Tom. You know, if I wanted Dad to win the race, he would have won the race.
I've always said that it was easier for me to race against my son than it is to stand there and watch him, because it totally destroys my emotions towards what's going on, and I get very nervous. I get more nervous watching him race than I do myself. So I would rather be in the race than standing there watching him.
So Al Jr. races on in his father's tire tracks, improving with every race, and not just his father's son now, a kid emulating his dad's every move, but a man with his own ambitions.
I want to make a lot of money. I want to be real rich. You know, I watch Dynasty on Wednesday nights, and I can do that. I can do that type of life. But I want to accomplish just some of the things that Dad has. If I can do half of what Dad has done, I would be successfully happy. I would be satisfied, because I would have smoked off the best, you know, and have won Indy and so on and so forth. I would be happy. I would be satisfied.
Well, it looks like that happiness may have to wait for a while, because suddenly he is out of the race. Al Unser Jr. quite unpredictably pulled into the pit. There is the helmet being removed, and it's all over for 1985.
It's incredible. His wife, Shelley, right behind him. He dropped out of the race roughly at this point last year, Jim. He was running second at that point. Boy.
Mario Andretti, though, still leading the race. 45-year old driving star. Here is Bobby Rahal, who led the race earlier, and he is just coasting, it appears.
I wonder if this is some extension of the earlier problem. Whatever the earlier problem was, it can't have been what I thought, which was the turbo, because he was able to resume running. I don't know. Attrition, Jim, you know, with the heat the way it is, has not been exceptional, although oddly enough, it's been hitting some of the leaders. A little different than usual.
Very true. And here is the way they stand. Holding solidly at the moment. Danny Sullivan fifth now, though. Let's see if we can get a relationship between the red car number 3, the leader in the race, and car number 40, the second place car, which is now, well, it's dropped back a little bit to 2.7 seconds behind. That's Andretti, the leader. Won this race in 1969. Now moving back, there is Andretti, that right there in your picture. Now, and there is the second car, number 40, and the third car, number 2, Tom Sneva, going like the wind, closing in on second place now.
Sneva, who so often makes his presence felt, Jim, in the middle stages of the race here, doesn't often run to the front in the early going, but this nevertheless is a tremendous surprise, because the Dan Gurney Eagle was not given that much of a chance, and yet they have come on and come on with the thing until they are now ultra competitive just when they need to be.
And there is Bobby Rahal finally coasting into the pits. Bill Fleming now with Al Unser Jr.
Al, what happened? All of a sudden, you just got out of the car.
Yeah, what happened was we lost oil pressure out there, and the engine started to lock up, so, you know, we just put it in neutral, and that's all.
You're running so good.
Yeah, well, Same this year, you know, same thing last year. We were running real good and we fell out and you know, just one of those things, I guess. We just go to the next race and try to win it.
Now, there was a lot of talk before this race began about turbulence. We haven't really discussed it yet here on our telecast. What about the turbulence on the track? Was it as bad as you thought it would be?
Well, the turbulence is bad, especially going into the corners at the end of straightaways one and turn three. You lose the whole car. You just don't lose the front end like you would if you were approaching a car coming off at two or coming off at four. And you're just losing the whole car and
you really have to stay on your toes.
You really have to be careful. And so
okay, thanks, Al. All right, back to you, Jim.
Interesting observation by Al Unser Jr. And there's Bobby Rahal out of the race.
Two heavy favorites, Jim, going out right at the same point. A major complexion change for the race.
Okay, sitting there talking to his wife, Debbie. Debbie Rahal, sort of a different kind of a racing driver's wife. We went to visit her, and this is what we found.
It's one version of the American dream, to live on a golf course, preferably one built by Jack Nicklaus, where Jack occasionally plays a home game, and to travel the world, to take a slow boat to China or a fast jet to Africa, to see and savor it all. Debbie Rahal has all these things, plus the added excitement of being married to a race driver. Of course, everything has its other side. Being married to a race driver means being married to danger. How does Debbie cope with that?
I think you have to divorce yourself from that. For one thing, you can't let them know that you might ever be afraid of what they're doing. Bobby knows that I have qualms about it. I mean, there are times when he's stepped out of a car and I've said, about law school, and he knows that I'm not always keen on it, but you get used to it.
Debbie Rahal doesn't fit the Hollywood image of a swinging race driver's wife. She's a lady of good taste who fills her home with soft furniture and antiques. She did meet her husband on a plane when she flew as a stewardess for the Irish airline Aer Lingus. She's a lady who likes fresh air, green grass, and animals. And if that's the old-fashioned and square, so be it. She likes the relationship between a human and a horse on a quiet morning ride.
As far as the horse goes, and the dogs follow along behind me quite often, but I get on him, and we go out, and there's a challenge between an animal that has his own mind and wants to do what he wants to do and seeing if I can convince him otherwise. For me, it's a very, very peaceful experience, and I love that. I can straighten out my own thoughts, figure out what I need to do, come back down to earth. Nobody's talking to you. Nobody's, you know, asking anything in particular. It's just the two of you.
But solitude is not the essence of Debbie Rahal's life. Much of the time, she's on pit row with her husband, a strapping 6'1" college graduate, Bobby Rahal. Debbie likes quiet charity work, much of which she does as the head of the CART Race Drivers Wives Association. Although the Rahals have no children, she works with the Special Wish Program, which fulfills the wishes of seriously ill children.
It's something I wanted to get involved in my mother's memory, because it's important to me to know that you can do something for them, do something special, and it's probably the greatest moment in their life. In most cases, it's a wonderful thing. And right now, I'll be involved in all the race-oriented wishes around the country. Any child that wants to go to a race, I'll help get the tickets, whatever it may be, the rooms, and make sure that once they're at the track, they have a good time and take them around and meet the drivers.
The trophy shelves are already groaning in the Rahal home in Dublin, Ohio. Bobby has won championships in the States and has raced in Formula One abroad. But Debbie makes no secret of what it would mean to them to win the Indianapolis 500.
That is going to be one of the most fantastic feelings for both of us. I mean, that's the pinnacle of Bobby's career, to win Indy, and to vicariously experience that thrill with Bobby is just going to be a wonderful, wonderful thing. Because any race, I mean, it just has to be a thrill for a driver to come around that last lap and to know that you've done it. But Indy, I want to feel that. I want to feel that for both of us.
Yet another dream that will have to wait at least until next year at Indianapolis. Bobby Rahal is out of it. In fact, the entire first row is now out of this race. And there are only four cars on the same lap. That's a little unusual at this point in the race, Sam.
Yeah, it's highly unusual. As is Mario Andretti getting cut off by a bunch of cars like that down tight.
There he is. Look at Mario Andretti, born in Italy, raised in Nazareth, Pennsylvania, leading at Indy, And Danny Sullivan has moved up to fourth place. Back again at the Indianapolis 500, Jim McKay with Sam Posey here, and there is the way they stand, Andretti, Fittipaldi, and Tom Stiva staying pretty much that way. And very good racing, however, at the moment between Fittipaldi and Tom Stiva for second place.
Two drivers with such incredibly different backgrounds as we pass the halfway point in the race. Interesting to see them almost wheel to wheel out here on the track, showing a lot of respect for each other because of the turbulence, because of the incredibly high speeds. Absolutely nobody wants to scuff it in the wall going 200 miles an hour.
There's Mrs. Fittipaldi in the pits. So many wives in the pits these days. 20 years ago at Indy, you would not have seen a woman anywhere in the pits.
You certainly wouldn't have, Jim.
There's Emerson, by the way, on the race course.
He's
driving a beautiful race.
Oh, yeah. We talked to Pat Patrick just before the start of the race, Jim, and he said that last night Emerson Fittipaldi came to the garage and sat in his car for over 2 hours all by himself.
What would he have been doing all that time?
Just feeling comfortable in it. You know, most of the time you're in the car, you're having to do this. You have to drive. It's terrific to be able to sit there calmly by yourself and just go through some of the things that might happen to you in the day ahead.
And you can do that for 2 hours. Just making it your home, is that the idea?
Yeah, it is your home. It's your cloister and your shield, too.
Fittipaldi, as we said, he was the youngest ever to win the Formula One World Championship in Grand Prix racing. Now 38, though. Some thought in the twilight of his career, and suddenly he came to the United States. Now here is Mario Andretti in the pits.
Looks routine.
Andretti, the race leader.
If you can say any pit stop is routine, when you consider the potential for things going wrong, Jim, when men work that fast with components of the car that are very hot, under great pressure.
However, at the moment, that makes Emerson Fittipaldi the leader. There he goes.
He retired from racing. He's passing Howdy Holmes there in car number 33. He retired from racing, stayed out of it for a couple of years, and has come back. That has become a trend now. Niki Lauda, who won the World Championship last year, retired and came back. Although he came back into his original world of Grand Prix, Emerson has come back into the world, a different world of racing than he left.
He's still being rather closely dogged, however, by Tom Stiva, who is now second in the race. Of course, it should be that they will have to come in for pit stops under the green unless something occurs. Here is Danny Sullivan coming in for a pit stop under the green light.
Yep. You know, interestingly, Sullivan practiced more, Jim, this month for this race than anybody else. He practiced for about 1,500 miles. Which says a lot about the Penske organization, by the way, their approach, the reliability of their machinery, and the depth of spare parts. How many engines do you think they burned to the ground, so to speak, in 1,500 miles of practicing? There he goes.
And here comes Emerson Fittipaldi into the pits.
So far, except for AJ's extravaganza, if you could call it that, and frankly, you really wonder why you need Broadway and Broadway actors as long as there's A.J. Foyt in the pits at Indianapolis. But there really, outside of that, hasn't been any spectacular action. Both cars up on those air jacks.
Okay, these are the two leaders at the moment. And both of them going out. We asked Emerson how he rated American drivers now that he's over here as opposed to European Formula drivers.
I think first, the American drivers are much more honest. Safety and performance. I mean, in Formula One, if they tell you something, you just go the other way. For sure, it's the opposite of what they told you. And here, as long as you respect the American drivers, they respect you. And I feel that, you know, I feel very comfortable. And I remember when you drive an oval, at this high speed we are going now, you cannot do any mistake. I mean, you know your life is there, and the next guy to you, his life is there. And I'm sure that creates a lot of respect. And the American drivers know that, and that's important. Sometimes you get young guys coming to Formula One that don't accept that. And they drive the way they like to drive, and they risk too much. And here, I mean, it happens, some accidents because of bad passing or bad overtaking, but you can see there's a lot of care at this high speed with the American drivers, and I like that. I feel very comfortable. And like every race before the race start on the oval, there is a driver's meeting, and they go through all the procedure, the yellow light situation, the pace car situation, and they tell the drivers to be careful drafting and passing each other. You know, it's a long race, 500 miles race, a long race. And I feel very comfortable with the American way of driving.
High testament to the Americans from Peter Paldi. And now, as a result of all the pit stops again, Mario Andretti in the red car number 3 has retaken the lead, but look who's moved quietly into second place, Danny Sullivan.
Mario Andretti is one of 3 men to have won both the Indianapolis 500 and the World Driving Championship. Who are the others? Mario Andretti is one of 3 men to have won both the Indianapolis 500 and the World Driving Championship. Who are the others? The late Jimmy Clark and the late Graham Hill are the only other men to have won both the Indianapolis 500 and the World Driving Championship.
Past the halfway mark now, and there was a tremendous shuffling of places under those pit stops with Danny Sullivan suddenly moving into second place in the race.
Yes, but of course, the leader of the race is still Mario Andretti, who's led it now more laps than anyone else. And at half distance, a little bit beyond, already there's a sense of a collective consciousness here in the crowd willing Mario on. Somehow there is nobody else in this race seems to need to win this race quite as much as Mario Andretti. In a way, it's making it into a kind of long, tense afternoon as everybody watches every step and hopes for him, hopes nothing will go wrong, that Andretti jinx won't come again.
And at the halfway mark, the entire first row, of course, is gone. The 2 Buicks and Bobby Rahal.
Yeah, it's almost an odd sort of 10 little Indians thing. All of the people that could have threatened Mario have started to fall by the wayside. Yet, of course, the early going was almost like sparring. Everybody seemed very gentlemanly out there. Suddenly, this battle for second has really intensified the action. The gloves are taken off now, and they're really going for it. But I am happy, by the way, for all the attrition, and I think a lot of it has to do with the heat, no one has been hurt. There's been no crash.
Okay, another look at the standings now. After 112 laps, Andretti and Sullivan, Fittipaldi, Sneva, Johnny Rutherford driving a beautiful race, moving up from 30th position. And here some of the drivers who are out of the race, Carter, who sat on the pole, Snyder and Garza, Brayton, and Tony Bettenhausen, the son of a great race driver, A.J. Foyt out of it, remember, and Ray Hall, Dick Simon at age 51, Al Unser Jr., and Whittington. We have a result of the World 600 in Charlotte today. Darrell Waltrip won it, and Bill Elliott, who could have won a $1 million bonus by winning it, did not. On the race course, look at this battle now for the lead. The 2 red cars, Mario Andretti, number 3, and number 5, Danny Sullivan.
Look at where Sullivan is running, Jim, way down under the yellow line. He's running a much tighter groove than Andretti. A very different approach to how to go fast here, and it is obviously working because he has closed in from several seconds out to where he can see Mario's tailpipe.
Danny Sullivan may be a new name to most people in the last couple of years, but he's been at this game a long time, for 13 years at the age of 35. He has paid his dues all over the world in racing, so he knows what he's about.
You know, it's one thing for Mario to have bad luck. It's quite another thing for him to be chased down on the racetrack and passed. Now, these are 2 different cars. Andretti's is a Lola, one of the very few in the field. There are only 6 Lolas in the field, compared to 25 Marches. Danny Sullivan has a March, a Roger Penske prepared March. There's the Haas Newman Lola. So these 2 cars may have very different characteristics. And so far, watching Danny run that shallow line over the yellow line down that low, Jim, that's very unusual.
I think it's interesting, too, that in this most American of all events, almost, there are not only many foreign drivers this time, but foreign cars, as you've been talking about, and foreign engines for the most part.
Yes.
In fact, all of the American engines in the race are now out of it. Danny Sullivan, though, is quite a story building here. We talked to him earlier, asked him what he thinks of the track at Indianapolis.
Well, I think the first thing from a driver's point of view that you notice is just the smoothness of the track, how smooth the whole place is around. The pavement is you know, like driving on a billiard table, if you like. And I think the other thing is just the crowd. I mean, you know, there's very few places, as you said, all the places I've been in the world, I don't think I've ever played in front of 400,000 or 500,000 people. And just to come out and, you know, go down into turn three and just all of a sudden the people start building up and you come out on four and just run down that tunnel of people, just thousands and thousands of people. It's a spectacular place.
So the drivers, believe it or not, are aware of this huge crowd while going at 200 miles an hour in those screaming race cars. Quite remarkable that you are aware of it, but you know that.
Yeah, you certainly are. Good point Danny made about how smooth the track is, by the way. It's the smoothest racetrack in the world.
Okay, another look at the standing. We're about to take a break. That's the way they are.
Indianapolis, Indiana. ABC Sports continues its coverage of the Indianapolis 500.
Nothing has changed. It's still Mario Andretti leading Danny Sullivan at Indy.
Just past the halfway point. There's a lot of racing yet to do and a lot of fuel calculations. Danny's rush to the front may be a function of his choice to use more boost to get back into the action that Andretti was using. Mario has led for a long time. It may have been his decision to make it kind of a quiet time for him. Both are able to get more than 30 laps to the tank full, which is impressive mileage, but of the two, Sullivan has been getting more. He got 34 laps to his last tank, Andretti only 31. So despite Sullivan's speed, he's running an economical race.
And that lead is dwindling by the second. Scoreboard showing it a half a second, but it certainly isn't. It's nothing now. Danny Sullivan going down low. Can he make the move? Sullivan down low. Side by side, Sullivan has the lead. Danny Sullivan, Kentucky, and just at that moment, losing control of the car, doing a magnificent job of not hitting the wall and continuing in the race.
Unbelievable.
It's unbelievable.
The incredible move maybe ever in Indianapolis, and Mario didn't hit him, Jim. That's even more incredible. Andretti subtly moving to the side like a fighter, taking a punch but letting it slip by him. Sullivan at 200 miles an hour recovering from that spin. You have to go back to Jim Clark in 1964-5, Jim, to get a move like that on this racetrack.
I've never seen anything like it on the Indianapolis racetrack.
Incredible.
Unbelievable, but he's going to come in. That may have caused problems in the car.
That is absolutely unbelievable what we saw. Of course, he must now stop because he's flat spotted those tires. He's coming down that very rough pit lane there, which keeps the speeds down.
Listen to the cheers for him.
Oh, it's incredible. This place has come alive. And of course, Andretti is in the pits too, both the leaders. But Sullivan is going to have to change all four tires because of that. Mario will go back out. You see, they're even changing that left front tire, which they never change.
Well, that'll cost him the lead, no question of it. But Danny Sullivan is back out on the race course. I have never seen a person take a spin like that and begin to slide towards the wall and still recover. Let's have another look at it. We're going to have slow motion here in just a moment.
I'll tell you exactly what I think happened, Jim, even before seeing it. Aerodynamic effects. Watch what happens. I'll bet you that if Sullivan gets in front of Mario... No, I'm dead wrong. It's running over that the white line. The very thing that he was doing that made him so fast, I think, tripped him in this one move. Yeah, Mario's too far back, I think, to have had a rear guard aerodynamic effect. But all right, now, Andretti, faced with the moment of his driving life, he can't see where he's going. Fades slightly to the left by a miracle. Sullivan stays wide enough to the right, hits nothing, and we may have seen the most dramatic moment of racing. Certainly that we're going to see this year. Incredible.
Well, there's a long way to go, Sam.
How good are those two drivers?
So as a result of all this, we now have Emerson Fittipaldi leading the Indianapolis 500. The yellow flag is out. And we may have another look at this. Here's the standings right now, however. It's Fittipaldi leading, and now Andretti and Sullivan in second and third. But now we have Fittipaldi in the pits, and that's going to change again.
Yeah.
A quick pit stop, though.
I'll tell you, I can't get my heart beat, frankly.
Still recovering from that,
yeah,
baby.
Yeah, really. I haven't seen anything like that in a long, long time. Danny Sullivan. Touch of luck, I think, frankly, too. There's
Penske. There's his crew chief, team manager and owner, Roger Penske.
Well, he's been at this
game. Maybe talking to Danny right now.
I don't think so. It's Derek Walker who talks to Danny on the phones, on the radio. Let's have another look at that, Jim, as we look at a different angle. Let's look at what Mario Andretti had to think about as all this was going on. Obviously, his first decision was to let Sullivan have running room on the inside. He didn't cut him off or anything. However, he didn't leave him a lot of room either, did he? So, all right. At the moment that Sullivan starts to lose it, and look at how quickly these cars can get away, Jim. It's so quickly. Andretti is suddenly driving blind here. As soon as the smoke starts to pour off Danny's tire. Mario, and this is with years and years of instinct, does the right thing. He didn't try to get between Danny and the wall. He went on the inside, which actually, although it looks easy here, in our shot, is the harder driving move to make because he had to pinch the car down instead of letting his car go wide. So Mario probably owes the fact that he didn't get involved in that crash to his years and years of driving and his perfect racing instincts.
So if either of those two drivers had been less talented or less experienced, that whole incident could have turned out much, much differently.
Oh, yeah, no question.
Andretti now back in the lead again. Sneva's moved to second, but he has to make a pit stop, and Danny is third. And now the green flag is out. The green flag is out. They're still showing on the scoreboard. Fittipaldi is the leader, but now they change it. Mario Andretti is the leader. Tom Sneva is now in second place, 1.6 seconds behind. And Sullivan still hanging there, only 1.9 seconds behind. Just amazing.
I think it's going to take a little while to get a grip on one's emotions. I guess that's what racing can sort of do. After laps and laps of running that you can predict the outcome of, it explodes in front of you suddenly, something that switches the whole order of things around and just shows the exemplary and utterly fantastic skills that these men actually have.
You know, there are those who claim that people go to automobile races only to see people crash. There was a graphic demonstration. People want to see, I believe, man winning out.
Fittipaldi!
Fittipaldi, my lord! Oh, my goodness. Oh, that is what people do not want to see. I don't know where.
Well, first of all, let me make sure I'm right. I just caught it out of the corner of my eye. I could be completely wrong. I am. It was Sneva.
Sneva.
There's Fittipaldi.
Sneva right here.
All right, there's Sneva.
Now, they say it may have been car number 20.
That's Rich Vogler.
Oh, no, it's 34, that's Vogler. Rich Vogler.
Yeah, 60, and Sneva was trying to pass.
I'm sorry, I don't think it is.
Vogler.
It's 60.
Okay. It is Rich Vogler. I think that's how I got Fittipaldi out of it. All right. There is Vogler. It was Sneva trying to pass Vogler in turn one. Sneva's great run now has come to an end in the first crash.
Tom Sneva out of his car, sitting on the pit wall, a little bit shaken, I'm sure. On the 123rd lap of schedule 200, there's Tom Sneva's wife.
Yeah.
On the right, Sharon Sneva. She doesn't know for sure.
Right, so it's Vogler we have to worry about. Tom Sneva is clearly okay.
Vogler. Rich Vogler, who started 33rd, the last starter in the field.
Got this ride literally at the last minute, getting into the race. Former USAC midget champion. All right, now here we come. That's Sneva on the outside, extreme left of your screen, and he is going to pinch down across, no,
No, he isn't either. There's Vogler taking the line. Sneva charges down into him.
Well, he just suddenly went right.
Yeah.
And into the wall.
It looked as if Sneva didn't see Vogler or thought he was further ahead of him.
There's Sneva.
Than he was.
Down low. And someone just getting by there. And then, hitting the wall. So they both did. Rich Vogler, a rookie who started 33rd in the field, 35 years old, however. He's been around for a while. First passed his driver's test here in 1980.
Now look at that wheel flying through. But now again, I've made an incorrect call because there was a third car involved. The triggering of this incident was a third car.
Just missed the driver.
Touching Vogler.
Yep.
Sneva. Here we go. Here's where the action starts. The car on the left here, which is Howdy Holmes. Look at that. It's Howdy Holmes that triggers the incident as he comes down on Rich Vogler. Sneva wasn't, it wasn't Sneva's fault even remotely. Sneva, my God, there's Andretti in the middle of all this.
Yep.
Andretti gets by it. Incredible.
And there was Sneva just beginning to go down in the bottom left-hand corner.
Yeah, Sneva spinning apparently needlessly, frankly. He wasn't that close to the action. Andretti was able to get by. That is incredible.
Well, there's his wife.
Yeah,
going down, I presume, to the garage or the hospital. He would have to go to the hospital for a check.
Oh, yeah.
No matter what.
But he looks,
and they're still trying to get Rich Vogler. Oh, they got him out on a stretcher now.
Yeah.
He'll be taken immediately to the field hospital. If necessary, will be flown by helicopter to the hospital downtown, which takes only 3 minutes by helicopter. The finest medical facilities at any race course in the world are here. So, some breathless moments at Indianapolis. The Danny Sullivan incident just before this. Matter of fact, we were recording on audio tape Danny Sullivan talking to his pit crew just after that occurred. There's Mario Andretti right here. But let's listen to what Danny said to his crew after the spin.
Okay, I'm still right behind Mario.
Stay out, Ed.
You okay, you say? Yeah, the tires are a little square, but I'm okay.
Okay, but you could hear Danny's voice was a little higher than the calm voice that you were talking to before.
Yes, that was, of course, after the first spin, not after this one, although, you know, Danny...
That was after Danny's spin.
That's right, and Danny was right on the road behind Mario as they both went through this, so Danny was very nearly in this as well. That was the voice, incidentally, of Derek Walker, his crew chief, talking to him on that radio hookup.
Now you see the marshals out there directing traffic away from the wreckage, which is still on the track. Let's take a break. A look at some of the 400,000 or so here gathered at Indianapolis, standing still, Andretti, Sullivan, and Fittipaldi, as the yellow flag is still out, the pace car on the track, leading the field. They can close up under the yellow here, remember, but you have to hold your place. There's Rick Mears, the defending champion, and he is out of it, the helmet being taken off. Rick Mears, though, what a comeback to even be in this race after his feet were absolutely crushed in an accident late last season. A month and a half in the hospital, then out of the hospital for a couple of weeks, back in the hospital for a month, walking with a cane, finally walking on his own just about a month or so ago. Well, Danny Sullivan out there, let's have a word with him. Danny Sullivan was very much in the middle of that picture, as you saw. We have a radio going to his car as we're under the yellow. We'll try to talk to him. Sam?
Danny, this is Sam. Can you hear me?
I read you loud and clear, Sam.
The last incident, it's as if lightning is striking all around you. What was it like from your perspective?
Pretty frightening, actually, because we were going in there quick, and I saw all those guys get tangled up, and one of them go up into the wall. And then Sneva stood on the binders and to kind of get his act together. He spun it right in front of me, and I just barely missed him.
How about your own spin at the same turn a little bit earlier? Not since Jim Clark in 1966 have I seen anyone control a car that way.
Well, I wish I could take the credit, Sam, and say that I was controlling it. I was just holding on. And that was my fault. We just had a little miscommunication, and I thought it was right toward the end of the race, and I needed to get by Mario.
it seemed as if you had been running a line very, very low, down over the white line, the yellow line. Was that part of what threw you out of control?
Absolutely. I had to go all four wheels down underneath there because Mario was leaning on me pretty good going into turn one. And just when I came back and hit it, the painted stripes, it just spun it around.
With all the things that have happened to you in the last few minutes on this racetrack, do you find yourself feeling okay nonetheless, feeling pretty normal?
Feeling great. I'm having a fabulous time out here, and I think it's been a pretty clean, good race so far.
Good luck to you. Thank you, Danny.
Thank you.
Very interesting, Sam, that he said he thought it was near the end of the race when they had about 80 laps to go. Is that normal?
No, that isn't. As he said, though, it's a miscommunication. He had to go for it, probably.
Okay, Danny Sullivan. Well, we said at the beginning he might be a factor and that he was a very interesting young man and one of the glamour figures of the sport right now. Let's meet Danny Sullivan. If you were writing a movie, you might name your race driver Danny Sullivan and cast an actor who looks and lives. We're talking about is, of course, a real-life, flesh-and-blood, successful race driver who also has the appearance and the personality to go with the dreamlike lifestyle he has chosen. He's just a kid out of Louisville, really, who went to a military prep school in the University of Kentucky, but he knows that swinging is good for business.
If you can't do that and you don't do that, you're just not going to generate the support from our sponsors. And I think that the proof was in the pudding last year where I was in all the Sports Illustrated and the Playgirl and this and the Donahue Show and whatnot. And everybody said, well, this is a little bit of a joke and you're carrying a little far. But the sponsors were knocking at the door and were offering about four or five times the amount of money for this next year. So you just have to do, that's what's changed in racing and that's what's important now.
Barney Oldfield, Ralph DePalma, and even A.J. Foyt would have snorted at the idea of sitting as a photographer's model. But it goes with the territory these days, and Danny makes the most of his commercial opportunities, which is not to say he doesn't tend to business. Since he started driving Formula Fords in England 13 years ago, he has honed his skills from Indy to New Zealand. He first raced in the 500 in 1982. The headquarters of Danny Sullivan Incorporated is this condominium in Aspen, Colorado, centrally located for skiing and sunning and for flying off to anywhere in the jet owned by his personal sponsor, Jim Stout. Jim knows all sides of Danny, and he likes him.
He's a fearless driver, and I think he handles his business affairs in that same fashion. He's very calculated, very precise, very smart guy. Danny will always do well.
Danny Sullivan is 35 years old, an age when most men have married or are seriously thinking of doing so. But the bachelor life still seems to fit Danny Sullivan. The slopes and the stars haven't lost their luster for him. Not yet, but neither has his profession. His road to prominence actually has been long and slow. Second in British Formula 2 in 1974, fourth in European Formula 3 in 1975, fourth in the New Zealand Formula Atlantic Series in 1978. In his Indy debut in 1982, he crashed on turn four. Last year, another accident forced him out early. But later last season, he won kart IndyCar races at Cleveland, Pocono, and Montreal. He has hit his stride, and he works hard to stay in top shape for victories to come.
I got to keep in shape, particularly from the stamina point of view. It's also a personal thing with me. I like keeping in good shape, but the stronger I am at the end of a 500-mile race, less chance I have of making a mistake.
I think the happiest moment of all the job, the whole racing, is just when I get to go out and actually do the race and buckle up, and then you don't have the telephone and don't have everybody out there. You're just doing what you do best and can concentrate on that. I think that's the only piece I really ever get out of the whole job.
The last line, very interesting. The only piece he gets out of the job is being out there where he is right now.
Yes.
Do you ever have that feeling when you were driving?
Yeah, absolutely. Although the pressure in my era back in the mid-70s from sponsors and supporters wasn't anything like what it is now, Jim. It's become full-time. It wasn't then.
Okay. Story of Danny Sullivan. Currently in second place at Indianapolis, as they're still under the yellow.
Over 1 million hot dogs are consumed during the month of May at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway.
Still under the yellow here at Indianapolis. Andretti, Sullivan, and Fittipaldi. It's been that way for a while. Tremendous dicing duel between Andretti and Sullivan, but Fittipaldi lurking all the while. Jack Arute now down in the pits with Rick Mears.
Things get very slow and very quiet in pit road when your car is out of the race, and for Rick Mears, that's the way it is right now. Rick's talking to one of his crew members, explaining to him what the problem was. Rick, what eventually put you out of the race?
Gearbox linkage seized up and just, I couldn't shift it at all. So that ended it for us.
Is it tough to gear down after going at over 200 miles an hour for about 250 miles?
Well, no, not really. I mean, you can't do a whole lot about it, so you've got to, but the car, the Pinzall car, was working very well. We were making some changes and kept having to start over at the back of the pack, and I had some trouble with my visor coming off my helmet, so I had to stop and fix that twice. But so every time we had to start back in the back of traffic and get going again, but the car was working well enough we could work our way up. So we were looking for the second half of the race to really start getting competitive.
Well, having worked your way up from the back, you've got firsthand experience with the turbulence here. How bad is it today?
Oh, you know, there's turbulence, but it's... These cars are a little more sensitive to it than last year's cars were, but the Pinzall car was working pretty good in it, and it was the same for everybody, so it didn't matter.
With the yellow still out, that is Rich Vogler being taken from the track hospital to the helicopter. We said he'll be flown from here to Memorial Hospital downtown, and that will take exactly 3 minutes to get him to the hospital. Bill Fleming is out there at the track hospital with Dr. Bach. Bill?
With me is Dr. Henry Bach, who is the medical director of the Speedway. Dr. Bach, you've just examined Rich Vogler. What's the story?
Yes, Rich Vogler has some facial lacerations and contusions, and he's on his way in Lifeline helicopter down to Methodist.
Is he conscious?
He is conscious and awake.
So you're really not that concerned?
Well, right now, an initial evaluation is guarded, but until we get him down there and look at him a little bit better, we're going to call him in fair condition.
Okay, how about Sneva?
Tom Sneva is awake and alert and does not appear to have suffered any injuries.
So you're not going to send him downtown?
No, not at this time.
All right, thank you, Dr. Bach.
You're welcome.
Just amazing, the safety of these modern race cars at 200 miles an hour. But here are the standings, Andretti and Sullivan, and look at them dicing behind the standings right now. They're really at it again. The green flag has come out, obviously.
Interesting, those standings, Jim, show Roberto Guerrero up into third now. He finished second in the race last year, so we want to keep our eye very much on him.
In the way of just creeping up through the standings, that's the way he did it last year.
Yes.
But look at this. This is a repeat, it looks like, of what we saw a while ago until Danny Sullivan tried to pass Mario Andretti and the wild incident occurred.
Yep.
Let's see how he sets him up this time, if he can catch him.
Well, once again, he seems to have the speed to close in on Mario in the turns. Watch that Danny runs that lower line. Mario is holding a fairly high line, the sort of thing you'd expect from Richard Petty in stock car racing. And it's giving Danny a chance, certainly to look very aggressive, attacking down there. Danny, of course, is one of these overnight discoveries, right, Jim? He began racing in 1972. So he has got tremendous experience. He's made a mistake, if you could call it that, on his first effort to get by Mario. He was obviously rushed by that miscommunication with the pit. Now he's going to size this up. Obviously, that's straightened out in his mind. He knows how much race is left now.
The reason it says M.A. Andretti is because his son's in the race, and that's M.I. for Michael Andretti. But look at this. They've got the crowd really going here now. Penske in the pit of Danny Sullivan, and there the sign.
Yep.
And here the move.
All right.
Sullivan.
No.
No.
No. Mario cuts him off.
But.
I'm going to
try again.
There's that low line through the short chute. No, again. And I'll tell you, Jim, you can sense not a shifting of allegiance exactly of the crowd. They are seeing what Danny Sullivan can do against the man, Mario Andretti, acknowledged to be the best at his business. And here's Danny giving him a run for his money.
In the emotions of the crowd, it's a case of sentiment against the future, perhaps.
Yep. And you can imagine the ambivalence that Paul Newman must feel, incidentally, owning, co-owning. Yep.
Here he comes.
Yeah, yep.
Danny Sullivan, side by side with this time.
Yep.
And he does not spin. High point, he takes the lead.
Yep, it's almost like I'm going to show you that I can do it. I'm going to grandstand it too, because that is, of course, turn one at Indianapolis, where the biggest crowd in racing sits. And that's where Danny Sullivan picked his point to take the lead. And look at him stretch it out. My God.
Amazing how quickly he's beginning to stretch it out.
Yeah, well, of course, that often happens, though, because Mario hit the turbulence there for a second, had to collect his thoughts. Mario hasn't had to run in second.
So Danny Sullivan finally makes it, and it was some long, hard job to get into the lead. Here it is.
He drafted him down the straight, and once again, he went over those lines, which can often cause the car to be a little unstable. Tires don't get that good a grip. This time, he knew exactly what he was doing. Nifty stuff. I was going to say, you know, that Paul Newman used to sponsor Danny Sullivan in the Can-Am series, Jim. So he was a big booster of Danny's 3 or 4 years ago. I imagine he's looking at this with some conflicting emotions right now. Two men that he's supported and admired their skills.
Weather can, by the way, continues perfect, at least for the spectators. Maybe a little hot in the race cars, although Bobby Rahal told us earlier from his car that it wasn't bad at all, really. Clear skies, however, that's the important thing. Just a gorgeous Memorial Day weekend and great racing at Indianapolis.
Quite a few of the drivers are running with helmets that are now air conditioned, which is kind of nifty. So many little technological advances.
How in the world do they do that?
Oh, it's with some chemical that flows through a headband or something. I'm not really sure how they do it, but I understand it works very well, and it's symptomatic of so many little technical improvements, never mind the major ones to the cars that have made them faster and safer, and Indianapolis somehow leads the way.
As people have been saying since the invention of the wheel, what'll they think of next?
ABC Sports exclusive coverage of the Indianapolis 500 continues.
Yes, we're back at Indy, and this is Jim McKay with Sam Posey in our commentary booth. Danny Sullivan still leads the race. Andretti second. Roberto Guerrero of Colombia, very much a presence in third place in the race. Look at the speed, the feeling that you get here. That's very realistic.
Yes, and yet at this stage of the race, Jim, often the drivers are almost anesthetized by the speed. The track is so smooth. The wall on the outside, there's Danny.
Danny Ungaius in trouble.
Danny Ungaius, his car is so instantly recognizable. That black car, he's driven the same kind of paint job for so many years. And all you can say, Jim, is it's good to see him out of the race, not in the wall. But that's about all you can say. What a disappointment. He's been driving a very fine race, in and out of 8th and 9th place in the last few laps.
Hawaiian-born Danny Ungaius, very much respected driver in the business. Back to the leaders, 5 and 3. That would be Danny Sullivan and Mario Andretti.
Sullivan pulling away.
Yes, he is.
Yep.
But would Mario be saving a little bit of boost for the end?
No, I don't think so.
Fuel strategy?
No, I don't think so. I think there have been enough yellows now that probably they have ample fuel and have got it cranked up. I can't surmise what the problem with Mario could be. He has been the fastest car more or less all month here.
And now they bring out the yellow because of Ungaius.
Ungaius, they'll have to tow that in.
So he didn't dump oil on the track, apparently, because they didn't bring the yellow out immediately. But because of the toe-in, they have to do it. So here comes the leader, Danny Sullivan, under the yellow, taking advantage of that to throw in a pit stop.
Now Sullivan's got some junk on the nose of his car. The crowd here, I must say, has been throwing a lot of stuff out on the road.
Yeah, it seems like an awful lot of plastic flying around here.
Of course, for 400,000
people. Oh, now we got them both in together. Yep. There is Andretti on the top, Sullivan on the bottom.
Well,
see who gets out first.
Pit crews in the business, working simultaneously.
Right, boom. Danny being pushed away.
Ripping through the gear.
And here comes Mario.
Four forward speeds here.
Nothing changed on that stop, I don't believe.
No. Sullivan. All right, Guerrero. That's Guerrero.
Okay, Guerrero into the pits. Still going well in third place in the race.
Come up to third. Guerrero had a marvelous drive here last year. Had a spin right at the end. You remember that?
Okay, looks like they're ready to go.
Yep.
A little problem. Oh, no. Got a problem getting going here.
Oh, no.
This is costing him a lot.
He stalled the engine. That's what happened. He stalled the engine. Now, all right, he lost, arguably, oh, boy.
Well,
I don't know.
15, 20, yeah. 25 seconds.
He flooded it, in effect.
You mean even as I do? Let's go to Jim Lampley with Carl Haas.
Carl, just prior to that last pit stop under the green flag, it appeared that Sullivan was running a little quicker. Are you concerned?
Well, yeah, we were a little bit loose, and we've changed our tires now, so we'll see what happens.
What about power? Is there room to adjust the boost upward for more horsepower?
No. We're at maximum boost all the time.
All right. That's the word from here in Mario Andretti's pit. Let's go to Jack Arut at Danny Sullivan's pit.
We've talked about fuel and the concern for it in some camps. It does not seem to be a concern here in the Penske camp with Danny Sullivan at the controls. You can see the fuel tank here and the measurements that are being taken. After this last pit stop, there was approximately 100 gallons left to go the remaining distance in this race. By our calculations, that would figure out, well, you'd only have to get about 1.2 miles per gallon, and the USAC rules call for well above that, about 1.7. So plenty of fuel left in the tank of Danny Sullivan.
Okay, still under yellow, that report from Jack Arut. Danny Sullivan leading Mario Andretti, but Andretti has a chance to close up here under the yellow. That is allowed. It'll be a very close start. Oh, it's been going on so long, since 1911. The favorite place is Gasoline Alley.
Once upon a time, in the latter part of the 20th century, there was a little town whose fame spread far and wide, Gasoline Alley. For most of the year, the little town is deserted, but when winter is over and summer draws near, a colorfully garbed band of nomads arrives and makes Gasoline Alley their home for about 4 weeks. Early morning, and life begins much as it does anywhere, with domestic duties and the sense that methodical preparation is a sort of shield for the uncertainties of what's to come. Inside the garages of the chariots the men have brought with them, strange machines as expensive as gold and requiring the moment-to-moment attention of a newborn baby. Some choose to work in secret, behind closed doors. Keep out. Security is tight. The borders are patrolled. The cars, hidden away, mysterious, receive all the attention. Machines are the focus here, not horticulture. It's crowded. It's crowded inside the garages, where the cars take up most of the space, and outside, where like tugs in a busy harbor, the tractors are always at work. Those who live here have to have patience, good humor, and a submariner's tolerance for living at close quarters, and they're always on display, like the inhabitants of a zoo. After qualifying, each garage gets its own address. The higher the number, the better the real estate, the deeper the envy of those who stand outside. This was Boardwalk. Uptown or downtown, though, the work goes on. The rest of the world seems barely to exist at all. When the spring rain comes, it is a resented intruder, an event beyond the control of those who work here, throwing schedules and routines into disarray. But worse, the pause gives you time to think. Too soon, this tall tower will tell the story of your month here. And for so many, it will be better to have hoped than to know. So back to work. The time to prepare nearly gone. The things to be done more numerous now, somehow, than when the month began. The sense of the imminence of the event with you always. Until it's time to put that which has been the best you could do to the test. Decisions made, too late now to change. Leaving home, not to return the same. And so, the nomads venture forth from Gasoline Alley to see which of them will be the fastest and the best.
Three quarters of the race gone by, and what a story is building here. in the lead. Danny Sullivan at age 35, it appears, an American hero in the making. And just behind him, still very much in it, the 45-year-old legend, Italian-born American hero, Mario Andretti. What a story it is.
Emotions are running so strong here, Jim. The crowd pulling so strongly for Mario early in the game, now coming alive with their enthusiasm for Danny Sullivan, who not that many laps ago had this incredible incident occur in turn one. As he moved to take the lead from Andretti, he got down very low on the apron, it's called, spun the car, and by a miracle, literally, when we talked to him, he didn't take full credit for keeping it off the wall, but he was able to keep it off the wall and keep going. A phenomenal piece of driving, the likes of which you might go 10 years without seeing. A piece of driving like that.
And it seemed like that was hardly done when we had another incident on the course.
Exactly. Also in turn one, this time triggered by Howdy Holmes moving down across in front of Rich Vogler. Immediately behind them, Tom Sneva, who had run such a marvelous race up to this point, Jim, and was becoming a real factor in the Dan Gurney Eagle, locking his tires up, locking his brakes up, and ultimately crashing along with Rich Vogler. Really a very disappointing incident to occur because it robbed us from the, you know, took Sneva out of the action at a point where I think he was destined to become a real third part of this leading group.
Okay, big American weekend, and we're at Indianapolis. The standings: Sullivan, Andretti, Fittipaldi, Guerrero of Colombia, Johnny Rutherford has moved up from 30th place to 5th. Al Unser Sr. penalized the lap, or else he'd be right in the middle of it. Pam Lion Dyke from Holland, the first Dutchman to drive in the race. Michael Andretti, son of Mario. And now the car's out of the race. There you see Pancho Carter, who sat on the pole. Jose Legarza, we saw him, his engine blow. A.J. Foyt had quite an incident coming into the pits there before he dropped out. Dick Simon, at age 51, was in the race today. Tom Sneva, you saw there, and Rick Mears. Okay, so some of the numbers and statistics and things that have happened here. Now look at this battle for second place that is going on right now between Mario Andretti and Emerson Fittipaldi. Andretti, remember, the red car, Fittipaldi in the white-looking car. And, you know, Emerson's just driven beautifully here today.
Danny Sullivan, of course, is ahead of them by several seconds now and still pulling away. So Mario, no longer a question of whether he can lead this race. It has become a question of whether he can defend second place against another former world champion. These men obviously have the greatest respect for each other and their exploits all around the world. And it's interesting to see Emerson Fittipaldi, after just one season of IndyCar racing, now has the expertise deep in this race to run with the likes of Mario Andretti. I think that is quite a phenomenal achievement. Of course, it pays a lot of respect, too, to his crew, the Pat Patrick team, which has consistently fielded top-notch equipment here, including Gordon Johncock's Wildcat, which is the last American car ever to win the race back in 1982.
Well, Fittipaldi, he had a look that time, and he decided to duck back in.
I thought he was going to make the pass. I didn't.
Yeah.
That's why I kept talking about Emerson. I think he has to set him up from a little bit further back than that, Jim, to make it work. But this could be it, because he got the momentum off the turn.
This is not for the lead. This is for second place. But great racing. Here's Fittipaldi. Now they're side by side. Oh. Into the turn. Here's where you can tell Andighi's got him.
Yep.
Well, it's been bad luck dogging Mario Andretti since he won in 1969. But today it isn't bad luck. It's simply beautifully prepared cars and fine driving moving ahead of him.
Well, yeah, but here again it's a question of the March car being driven by Fittipaldi versus the Lola of Andretti. Maybe there's a difference there.
Could be. Thirty-nine laps left of a scheduled 200 in the Indianapolis 500. Sullivan leads by a comfortable margin. Fittipaldi and Andretti still fighting for second place. Roberto Guerrero of Colombia in fourth place. And Johnny Rutherford again, who started in 30th position, in fifth, but one lap down.
Rutherford's doing a terrific job, Jim. I didn't think he had that kind of chance.
No question. But Roberto Guerrero is also. His wife is an American. It's an interesting.
Guerrero. Love has everything to do with it. A piece of history they passed along to us a few days ago in Gasoline Alley.
A story of romance. Katie, it is told to me in pits and garages that the dream of a lot of sophisticated women is to meet the race car driver. Was that ever a part of your picture?
No, I had more in mind a lawyer or a doctor, to be perfectly honest with you. Before I met Roberto, I didn't know anything about racing, therefore I didn't like it at all. In fact, that's putting it mildly, I really hated it. Not anymore. I was traveling with some friends in Europe, and I was in Monte Carlo for the race as purely spectator, and I was invited to a party on a yacht. And when Roberto walked on that yacht, this sounds so corny, but it's true, I said, I'm gonna marry that guy. I just fell in love with him when I first saw
him. Yes, I didn't have a chance to start with. You know, I was doomed from the beginning. I'm glad she did, though.
Katie, it's customary to ask the wife of a race car driver about fear. Do you fear the risk that he takes?
There's always that element of fear. I'm always nervous when he's out there, but instead of harping on that side of it, I really like to look at the safety aspect. You know, any time there's been a big accident, there have been injuries, but not really anything that you would expect. You know, oftentimes they'll have a huge accident and jump out without a scratch. And if there is a big accident and there is something wrong with the car, you know, the following year they always work on that and they bring the car up to a better spec, where that's the thought that I hang on to, that the cars are getting safer and he's not allowed to crash.
Did your attitude toward that element of your job change as a result of being married?
Not really, because you don't actually think about it when you're driving. You know, you're concentrating so hard that any other thought just doesn't cross your mind. And obviously, I think the time when you start thinking and worrying about it, that's probably the time when you have to stop. Because if you let that worry you, you're not going to be able to do the job you're supposed to.
One thing I'm sure you're both thinking about now is the impending arrival of the first Guerrero child in September. A race car driver?
Tennis player. Every day I say, please be a tennis player. One race car driver per family is definitely enough.
Okay with you?
Yeah, I would be quite happy if he'd be a tennis player too, but at the same time, you know, the chances are that, you know, growing up in an atmosphere of racing, he'll probably want to be a race driver, and if he does want to, we'll support him.
What if it's a she?
If it's a she, definitely not.
Apparently the she hadn't occurred to Roberto. Danny Sullivan, however, is the leader in the race. Guerrero is in fourth place. Here's the relationship now to Emerson Fittipaldi in second place. It's not over. It's not that much distance between these cars. But that is the way they stand.
From the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, the Indianapolis 500 continues.
His lead in the Indianapolis 500. It's now up to 11 seconds over Emerson Fittipaldi of Brazil. Mario Andretti still running third in the race, but it's the Sullivan story up to here and looking more and more like it all the time. You can see the shimmering heat coming up from the track, but again, it's strange, but it doesn't seem to have been bothering the drivers today. I think the humidity is quite low for one thing. In some years gone by, we've had tremendous humidity here. The relationship, the difference between the cars, watch as he crosses the yard of brick, the start-finish line. 11.4, so he's nudged it up a little bit more again.
Boy.
Sullivan to Fittipaldi in second place.
He's running away with it. You know what, Jim? I mean, that's seemingly he's been, you know, when you think he was really quite far back of Mario at one stage. He came all the way up, caught him. And then there was a sort of the period of confusion there because of his spin and then the subsequent crash involving Rich Vogler. And now he's just streamed on ahead.
Of course, you know, under the modern day rules here in Indy, there's still the possibility if a yellow flag comes out that Fittipaldi can close up that difference between first and second under the yellow and then see if he can catch him again.
Oh, sure. Yeah, and all right, here's Fittipaldi into the pits. Yeah.
Okay, routine pit stop.
Remember, every time they come into the pits, tires changed, the suspension possibly changed, the car may go a little faster.
And Sullivan also, of course.
Yeah.
Sullivan also will have to make a pit stop.
However, they're not changing the tires here, interestingly. And the fuel is flowing very slowly at this late stage in the race. Notice how much longer a pit stop is now than it would have been earlier. Evidently, Emerson's car must be handling fine because they didn't see the need to make any adjustments. That would seem to blunt any opportunity for him to attack Danny.
Well, you said the fuel flows more slowly toward the end of the race. This is a gravity.
Oh, what?
There's a crash. That is 43. That's John Paul Jr. Paul Jr. down into the grass after hitting the wall. And that does bring out the yellow, but now Pitapaldi pitted under the green.
Right.
That's going to cost him.
Yeah, that. Now there's the kind of racing luck that Sullivan, and for that matter, Andretti, need. Obviously, the yellow is out now. They will be able to duck in and make pit stops under the yellow. There's John Paul
Jr. Let's see if this driver's all right. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, notice the nose of that car. Jim, how intact it is. That's part of the new regulations for this year. Here's Mario Andretti.
Under the yellow.
Now a piece of luck that he desperately needs, even in his battle for second. This actually could be decisive. A big advantage for him. And they are changing those tires, desperately trying to get the handling to be better. But you know, looking at that John Paul car, it's terrific. That nose cone held up so well. That's part of the change that most of the cars have made this year. New safety regulations.
Here's Danny Sullivan.
Danny, also under the yellow, of course, to protect the driver's feet. Last year, there was a whole rash of injuries to people's feet. Rick Mears, of course, we know about that. But many others were hurt as well. Sullivan not, though. He has led a charmed life.
The ballet of the Penske pit crew.
Roger loves all this kind of thing. You know, he's a guy that deals with strategy every day in his business. So when he comes here, all right, here's John Paul. He's all right, and he's walking around. Incredible, really, Jim, when you think of how hard he hit that wall. I mean, all right, here we go.
Oh, look at that tire.
Yeah, there must have been triggered by a wheel coming off of his car, because that wheel, you know, was off the car, Jim, long before he hit the wall. And you see again, I make that point about the nose being fully intact. It's terrific to see. Much safer than ever, really.
No question about it. The man of the moment sits in car number 5, Danny Sullivan. Let's have a word with him.
Danny, this is Sam Posey. Can you hear me?
Raise your loud and clear, Sam.
Danny, we're getting very near the end now. Could you describe for us the track conditions? The wind seems to have picked up a little bit. Is it affecting you?
Well, it takes the car whatever bad characteristic you have. If your car's a little bit oversteering or a little bit understeering, it magnifies that in certain corners. But you just got to be a little careful.
Your own mood with the race so close to the end. How are you doing?
Doing pretty good, but this is when you start doing everything and you get worried because I got Mario only 2 cars behind me.
Good luck to you, Danny. We'll see you at the end.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so now it's Mario Andretti in second place, and as Danny indicated, not that far behind him when that green comes out. There's Roger Penske. Some anxious moments still remain in this race. He's got a loyal pit crew. Here's one of them. The Roger Penske Racing Team is a model of organization and efficiency. Nothing left to chance. Every part of the car in shining condition. Every tool at hand. Every crew member alert and well-dressed. But every member must eat also. Frank Mundy is the man who feeds them. He's a former stock car driver who helped found NASCAR with Bill France one January day in 1947. His relationship with the Penske team is special, and Roger remembers how it started.
I saw Frank the first time driving a Kike for Chrysler in stock cars, and got to know Frank over the years. He followed IndyCar racing, and he always came with us, helped us, kind of as our super chef, you might call him, great guy. The fellow supplied us with the best food in the pits day or night.
Team drivers Rick Mears and Alan Sir Sr. fuel themselves with Frank's food, while others fuel their cars. Frank Mundy is up at 7 o'clock every morning here at Indy, making about 90 sandwiches a day, wrapping them neatly. Remember, everything with Penske is neat.
When they started racing in Atlanta after I retired from racing in 56, I started going out and feeding them, and, you know, since we were good friends, and also it made me feel like a little more a part of racing. I'd loan them my motorhome, cooked shrimp for them, and they appreciated it. And now, instead of playing golf or fishing, my main hobby now is to follow the whole circuit. So I bring the food on the plane. I make it at home into my own kitchen. And you might say I'm a self-proclaimed gourmet.
When he stopped driving stock cars, Frank got into real estate and boat building and did it very well. He and his wife, May, live in a nice house near the governor's mansion in Atlanta. And he's not wanting for basic transportation, but he loves being in the pits.
Boys treat me just like one of the teams, so I'm real fortunate in the fact that I picked a winning team and that I'm on a winning team.
I tell you, the Penske team needs leave absolutely nothing to chance. But get a look at the crowd here. Every one of them still on the alert. It's not quite over. We continue to race towards the end of the Indianapolis 500. Danny Sullivan, the leader. Andretti, second. Guerrero, third. 24 laps left in the race now. Debris flying around the track. Earlier, a piece of it got on Mario Andretti's car. Didn't cost him in this case, however. There is the leader, Danny Sullivan of Louisville, Kentucky.
With 24 laps to go is a critical strategic point because with the tanks topped up, they can now make the rest of the distance without any pit stop. So we are, unless there's another yellow, we're going to see a dash for the end.
Okay, there is Danny Sullivan, and just in front of him, now look who's in front of him. It's Michael Andretti, the son of Mario. Mario, trying to gain on Danny Sullivan, is behind there and not very far behind.
Nope, there he is.
Is Michael Andretti doing a little blocking job as Al Unser Jr. appeared to do for his father a couple of years ago?
Well, there's certainly every possibility. Michael, because of the good radios, good radio communication everybody has, I would say there's no doubt that Michael is aware, at least by now, of the situation. Yeah, he's going to make it hard for Danny to get by. I don't know how hard, though. And Danny has got a really quick car this stage. I don't know. Yeah, I think this is very exciting. Here
sure.
It comes. Look at this.
Mario is gaining the red
yes,
car behind
is.
The other red car.
Yep.
And Michael is still hanging in front of Danny.
Yeah, and you know, Michael doesn't have to block him, per se, because of this turbulence factor. That alone is enough to keep Danny at bay for a lap or two. Look at how much closer Mario is now. Jim, look at that. Mario's right in the picture.
A real factor in the race. We've got a race going again.
Yeah.
Thanks, it appears, to Michael Andretti,
well,
who's just holding his own.
Well, okay.
Danny's made it this time.
All right, yeah, but I don't think it's over because Mario had started to close in. Mario, you know, changed some things on that last pit stop.
Well, look at this. Fittipaldi coming into the pit.
Can't be routine because he stopped way too recently for this.
Very tough break, but the race still goes on from first and second place. But it looks to me like, yeah, Sullivan is pulling away again. Pulling away again. For a moment there, it looked like this could have been a dash to the finish, but I think Sullivan's just got too much. Nothing untoward occurs.
Yeah, but so many things that can go wrong. I mean, as simple a thing as all the debris on the track. I mean, some of that could lodge in a radiator or something like that. Sullivan, you mentioned, of course, Louisville, Kentucky. Jim, home of the Kentucky Derby. Here's Danny from Louisville, Kentucky. That name suddenly coming up in this month of May.
Yeah, we started the month in Louisville, and here we have a man from Louisville perhaps about to win the Indianapolis 500. Must be so frustrating for Mario Andretti. This was going to be the year, and nothing really has gone wrong with his car.
Nope. This was to be the centerpiece, really, this Indy victory for Mario, the centerpiece of the whole Newman-Haas effort. This whole team that they put together a couple of years ago worked so hard on. Mario's the national champion. He won the race at Long Beach. It was the race before this. And now, at the most critical moment, his car does not have the speed. It just does not have the speed. That has got to be incredibly galling to Mario Andretti.
But still, the 400,000 are in place.
Oh, I can't believe it. Oh, this is far from over. He's passing Derek Daly. Danny Sullivan passing Derek Daly. I remember back to the very first day Danny Sullivan ever came to the Indianapolis track. I happened to be here. I watched him register and everything. There's Emerson Fittipaldi out of his car. What a contrast to A.J. Foyt, incidentally, Jim. No histrionics. And after a much more bitter disappointment.
Oh, Bill Whittington up against the wall in car number 12.
Huh.
So that'll bring out the yellow again.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
And the not yellow. That many laps to go. This is a good finish under the yellow flag.
Yeah, it's that close. Well, that gives Mario one more shot.
Yep. With just 12 laps, 8 laps now, actually, left in the race, the yellow flag is out.
The closest finish in the history of the Indianapolis 500 was in 1982, when Gordon Johncock beat Rick Mears by 16 hundredths of a second.
We are going to get a green flag with 3 laps to go after the yellow came out because of the crash of Bill Whittington's car. Whittington walking away from that crash, apparently all right. But we're going to have a dash to the finish. The 2 red cars are the ones to watch. Because of closing up under the yellow, the lead of Danny Sullivan over Mario Andretti is only 1.5 seconds. And 3 laps for Mario to make it up.
The crowd
urging them both on. Mario, 16 years after winning his only Indianapolis 500, was the favorite here today. At age 45, it could be his last chance. And he's got 3 laps to try to get by 2 cars and catch Danny Sullivan of Louisville, Kentucky. The green out. And here they come.
Well, Jim, in that yellow, neither Sullivan nor Andretti pitted. So Andretti's car, they have not been able to change it in any way at all. Sullivan was able marginally to outrun him before. Andretti has already moved by one of the 2 guys he had to pass. He moved by Kevin Cogan, incidentally, his nemesis, the man who put him out of the race at the start several years ago. And now he's breezing by Howdy Holmes. Neither of those men wanted to get in the way of Mario Andretti.
He's behind him, Al Unser Sr., who's a lap down and who would be right in this dash had he not been penalized a lap earlier in the race for running over his own air hose in the pit.
That is
but
true.
Danny Sullivan seems to have that same lead. But how careful he has to be on these last couple of laps.
And once again, what do you think? Penske's cars are, with just a couple of laps to go, now 2 laps to go, running first and third, just as they did at this point last year, Jim, in a race which, of course, was run by Rick Mears. This year, it may be Danny Sullivan.
But he has now lengthened that lead to 2.4 seconds. The next time around, he will get the white flag, indicating 1 lap to go for the leader, just 1 to the checkered flag. Looking around inside the car, it appeared there.
Yeah, Sullivan has worked as a janitor, a cab driver in New York, a hand on a chicken farm, a waiter, a lumberjack, a sod cutter, but I don't think he's ever worked at a job quite like this, winning of the Indianapolis 500.
Here comes the white flag, 1 lap to go for the 35-year-old who, at the point you make so well, Sam, he is known as the swinging bachelor of the circuit, but he has paid his dues. All the menial jobs he had with 13 years of racing behind him.
Yes, he has, but for all of the things that I hope and wish for Danny Sullivan, and I'm one of his greatest fans, this man, Mario Andretti, looks as if he's headed for defeat today on the day he said he had the best chance ever in his 20 years to win the Indianapolis 500. I feel incredibly for Mario, who put so much work and so much hope into this and is coming up short just a few seconds worth.
The old American hero will lose the race. The new American hero is Daniel John Sullivan III of Louisville, Kentucky, who has won the Indianapolis 500. Mario Andretti finishing second. Roger Penske, the crew chief. Now is the time to celebrate. They didn't budge a muscle until he had crossed the start-finish line, that yard of brick, for the last time.
The
Roger Penske team winning for the second year in a row.
Yes, the changing of the guard that you spoke of earlier, Jim, now personified in the face of this man, Danny Sullivan.
The top 5 then, Danny Sullivan, second Mario Andretti, third Roberto Guerrero of Colombia, fourth, Al Unser Sr., one lap down. And in fifth place, and quite remarkably, Johnny Rutherford, who came from 30th place, the three-time winner of the race, to finish fifth. A view of the wide scene, the 400,000 still in place. No traffic on 16th Street right now, but wait for about 10 minutes. Danny Sullivan headed for Victory Lane at Indianapolis. A moment he has to have dreamed about, thought about, planned for, but I would imagine, Sam, you're never quite ready for it.
Jim, he gave up a promising career in Formula One just 2 years ago to take a chance on IndyCar racing, and this is where that chance led.
Danny Sullivan. Danny, this race is likely to be remembered for the one remarkable moment with just a little more than 80 laps to go when you spun twice and came out of it. Your frame of mind after that, were you able to completely block that particular moment of danger out?
Well, I looked at it this way, that the sun was shining on me. That if I got away with that and was still in the race and was still in second place, somebody was looking after me. And I figured if we could do that and still come back, we had a good shot at it. And I knew that I could run with just about anybody, and I knew I had to measure on Mario, so we were just looking for to stay out of trouble. And then when that happened at the restart with all those guys down there, and we got through that, I knew we were making it home.
You've worked as a waiter, a chicken farmer, you've done a variety of things to get to this point. Did you have a feeling when you were brought into the Penske operation that you had reached a plateau of comfort in racing?
Well, I figured when I got to the Penske operation, I'd gotten to the top team in motor racing. But I figured also that this was where the work was really cut out for me, because these guys demand a lot from you, expect a lot from you, but in the same token, they give a lot in return. And I knew that if I gave 110%, they would, we'd come up with a result. And the proof's in the pudding. Here we are.
Now, you told Sam Posey during the race that at the time you spun, you thought that the end of the race was near. How could you have been that lost in the lap count?
Well, I just asked Derek out of curiosity how many laps to go. I hadn't looked at the pit board, and I misunderstood him. You know, the radios aren't always that clear. And in my excitement, I thought, I better make a go of this. There's only about, you know, 12, 13 laps left, and we were just wrong.
How much of your present satisfaction derives from having won a duel with one of the greatest names in the history of the sport, Mario Andretti?
Well, Mario is always a gentleman and a champion to race against, just like the other 33 guys out there, or 32 guys, and I enjoy it. I love winning them this way. I would have liked to win it by two or three laps, but I'll take them any way I can get them. This was great.
This is the story of happiness in winner's circle. The story of disappointment is at Mario Andretti's operation, and Jack Arruda standing by there.
For Mario Andretti, he came close, but Mario, close isn't any good at Indianapolis, is it?
That's right, anywhere.
What could you have done differently, do you think? Did you ever settle the handling problems that you had?
No, I ran as hard as I could, and I think we rang out everything we could out of the car. I don't think there was no one's mistake at any time during the race. I ran as hard as I could. We tried a couple of different measurements on the tires, and we knew what we needed to get the most out of the car. I got the most out of the car. It just wasn't good enough, that's all.
What were your thoughts and your feelings when you went through the Danny Sullivan incident?
Well, I thought it was rather weird the way he tried to do it. I gave him plenty of room, and he pinched it down there. I knew that once I took him down, he took the bait. Once I took him down so deep, I knew that he was cooked. But, I mean, he was just lucky, that's all.
And now we're back live again. It's almost 11 o'clock Indianapolis time, p.m., Indianapolis Motor Speedway. A very, very different scene. A look now at the unofficial results. They won't be official until 8 o'clock tomorrow morning, but no changes are anticipated. There you see some of the others. The Dutchman, Leyendijk, did very well in his debut here as a rookie. That's what the R means. Fittipaldi finally dropping all the way down after battling all the way. Going down through. Rich Vogler started 33, finished 23, but he crashed, of course. Dick Simon at age 51, tried again. A.J. Foyt at age 50. And finishing last in the race, the man who started first. And what has been happening with Danny Sullivan since the race ended some hours ago now? Well, let's have a look, because we've been following him. This was Danny going back to his garage in Gasoline Alley. Pretty tough to get through the crowd, but they did make way for him. Somehow, people make way for winners. A few cheers right in the garage area. Here he is with his crew. Time for congratulations, and
We remember none of them budged until he crossed that start-finish line. There was no congratulations, no handshaking until it was all over. Then the press conference, and there will be a lot more press conferences yet to come for Danny. Part of the price of being a winner and being a hero. Now going to the Roger Penske Hospitality Suite. That's across in turn two. There's parents, Peggy and Dan Sullivan from Louisville, Kentucky. What a great day in their lives. Danny and his mom there.
Daniel John Sullivan III was born in
and what did he do next? Well, he watched our telecast. Danny Sullivan, winner of the Indianapolis 500. I wonder where he is now. Well, of course, as it happens, Danny Sullivan is with us right here. Nobody left, Dan, except about you and me. You've had some hours to think it over. Has the realization set in?
Not really. As you've seen from all the previous footage, it's been kind of busy and a lot of press conferences and doing interviews and so forth and a lot of signing autographs and so forth. I think it'll sink in sometime tomorrow.
Just a wonderful ride. Congratulations to you. It couldn't have been better done. There were no tough breaks for anybody, really. You just did it.
Well, it worked out pretty good for us. We had, of course, that one moment that everybody saw on TV and probably see him many times again. You know, the Miller American Penske ran solid all day long. We had some problems early on, and then we just got it all together and ran it hard.
Understand you can get about 5 hours sleep before Good Morning America. And congratulations again to Danny Sullivan. A report on the injured drivers now, just before we leave you, and this is going to require the glasses, and it'll have to be quick. They are all okay. Rich Vogler, cut to the face, good condition. Bill Whittington, chest pains. They think, however, it's just muscle pains, good condition. John Paul Jr., maybe a fracture of a bone in his right wrist. He's not in the hospital tonight. He'll be back for an x-ray tomorrow. So that's the story. We've been here since 8:45 this morning. It's almost 11 o'clock at night, but what a day it has been. Thank you for being with us. This is Jim McKay with Sam Posey and Jim Lampley and Jack Arute and Bill Fleming saying so long from Indy.